is my great pleasure to introduce Honorable Peggy Knowlton Dunlop, Vice President for External Affairs of Heritage Foundation.
Thank you very much. Well, let me express my welcome to you today on behalf of the President of Heritage, Jim DeMint, and the entire Heritage team. We are always delighted to welcome ICAS as a partner in events here today. We have a great program for you this afternoon, and I'm going to introduce the president of ICAS, Sinja P. Kim, who is a wonderful professional lady and a great partner, and she can take the program from here. Please come on up.
Thank you.
Welcome to Heritage.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good to see you, and thank you for joining us today. I'm Sinja Kim, president of ICAS, and I'd like to welcome all of you to the ICAS Fall Symposium 2015. In today's program, we will continue to discuss the Korean Peninsula issues, the evolving dynamics of the Northeast Asian geopolitics, and the U.S. global leadership in the 21st century. And these subjects should be all very familiar to you. During all those years that we've been discussing these subjects, the nature of these issues of the underlying fundamentals have not changed. And yet, the context of those issues have been changing at each occurrence of the changes and new developments in and around the peninsula, causing the shifts in the dynamics in the regional regions and with the consequences reflected in the regional landscape, economically, politically, militarily, and also in the diplomatic pursuit. The last 6 months has brought us yet another significant milestone in Northeast Asian geopolitics, with the three Northeast Asian leaders' state summits back-to-back during a highly testing period for all those three parties. So while our memory is still fresh, we would ask, what are the broad implications of the South Korea's future courses of actions in the way of achieving the peace and security in the peninsula and its aspirations for the expanded contributions to the global peace agenda as a meaningful partner with the U.S. in its initiative of rebalancing to Asia? And what would be the prospect of the global U.S. global leadership in the 21st century in view of the rising power in Asia, while the overall global dynamics are still continuing as fluid, so to speak? So that brings us here today at this platform. We try to gather and gain better insights for all these complex and critically important issues before us. Now, please let me add that today's symposium is very significant for all of us. We are delighted to present this event today in partnership with the Heritage Foundation and the Korea Times, the first English daily in Korea. So we have five speakers here today, and it is my distinct pleasure to have among the most distinguished thinkers in this business with us today: Joseph Bosco, Glenn Fukushima, Bruce Klinger, and Michael O'Hallen, and Ambassador Jun-ho of the Korean Mission to the United Nations, who is coming from New York later on today. And each of those remaining four speakers will come in and join us in his slot as we proceed. And we have a team of distinguished discussants today. They're all ICAS fellows. Joseph Bosco, who is wearing two hats today, and Peter Hussey, Tong Kim, and Dave Maxwell. So that's it. And before we start, a little bit of housekeeping matters. We do not have the official break during the period, during the session. So you are welcome to walk out to the foyer. There's a drink and sodas available. And after the session, we have a reception, and all of us, let's gather, all of us there, and have a little catch up, okay? And with that, we'll have the moderator, Sangju, will take us from here, and I hope all of you enjoy the program. Thank you very much.
Okay, this is part of what I do. Okay, Minggu will introduce our first speaker. He's one of our deep bench. He's only 11th grader in high school. All right, he will introduce Joe Fosca.
All right, thank you, Dr. Kim, for this opportunity to introduce Honorable Mr. Joseph Bosco. So, Joseph A. Bosco, ICAS Fellow, served as China Country Desk Officer in the Office of the Secretary of Defense from 2005 to 2006. He is presently a National Security Consultant and a Senior Associate at the Center for Strategic and International Studies. Joseph earned his AB degree from Harvard College, his LLB degree from Harvard Law School, and his LLM degree from Georgetown Law Center. He served in the U.S. Navy in the Western Pacific. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Mr. Bosco.
Oh, just, okay, thank you.
Good, thank you.
You know what? Tong's going to read Korea Times greeting first. Okay, good. Thank you, Tong. Yeah. Now, the Tong Kim will speak on behalf of the president of the Korea Times.
This is a short remark from Changsub Lee, the publisher and president of the Korea Times. He asked me to read the following. I take this opportunity to extend my greetings to Shinja Kim and Sangju Kim, ICAS chairman and vice president, and to the distinguished speakers today, and he listed all the names, but I won't skip them because they've been already mentioned. All of you are familiar names to Koreans, and particularly to the Korean our readers. Korea Times is very pleased to support this ICAS symposium now being held at the Heritage Foundation. Ahead of its 65th anniversary of publication on November 1, Korea Times is Korea's first English daily, as Shinja mentioned, and we published the 20,000th edition of our paper on April 3 this year, marking a landmark in the history of our paper. We are certain that our readers will greatly benefit from your expertise and your insightful discussions of timely topics of importance. Your discussions will be featured in our anniversary special edition on November 2, together with a webcast of the event. I am sure that your professional and impartial policy views will be a great stimulant to the strengthening of the Korea and U.S. alliance and to the promotion of peace and stability on the Korean Peninsula and in Northeast Asia. Korea Times plans to support a similar conference each year in search for a long-lasting friendship with the United States and a better future of the Korean Peninsula. We express our appreciation to the ICAS, the Heritage Foundation, and all the participants. Thank you.
Thank you. So now it's really your turn.
Thank you, Dr. Kim, Dr. Kim, and ICAS for the invitation to be at this august institution. The title of that was presented to me was Evolving Dynamics of Northeast Asian Geopolitics. I've added to that : The Legacy of Two Foreign Policy Realists. I thought it'd be useful for us to see how we got to where we are from the perspective of the people who actually were the architects of the policies that we're now seeing implemented today. Along with the threats posed by ISIS and international terrorism and the resurgence of Russian aggression in Ukraine and Syria, the deteriorating security situation in East Asia is a cause of mounting concern for the United States and countries in the region. China's increasingly assertive actions in the South China Sea, its history-based hostility to Japan and the West, the use of cyber warfare against the United States by both China and North Korea, and the reckless threats of nuclear strikes that periodically emanate from both countries make East Asia potentially the most dangerous region Washington must confront. In all cases, China is the pivotal player, either because of its own direct actions or because of its continuing support for three generations of the Kim family tyranny in Pyongyang. Military scholars now openly debate scenarios for war between the United States and China over Taiwan, or over freedom of navigation in the South China Sea or East China Sea, or on the Korean Peninsula. We may ask, how did it come to this? After Nixon's historic opening to China and almost 45 years of intensive Western engagement carried out by 8 successive U.S. administrations. When he returned from Beijing in 1972, Nixon proclaimed to his aides that his opening of relations, quote, would reduce the chance in the immediate future of a confrontation between the United States and the PRC in Asia, such as we had in Korea and such as we had indirectly in Vietnam. Nixon was equally sanguine about the long term. He said, looking further in the future, when they become a nuclear superpower, we will have such relations with them that we can discuss differences and not inevitably have a clash. No one can look at Asia and take 750 million Chinese out of it and say that you can have any policy in the Pacific that will succeed in preventing war without having the Chinese a part of it. It is just as cold-blooded as that. In expressing his confidence in the value of engagement with China, Nixon was reflecting the flip side, the sober assessment of not engaging China that he had made the year before he was elected president. In his seminal Foreign Affairs article, he stated, "We simply cannot afford to leave China forever outside the family of nations, there to nurture its fantasies, cherish its hates, and threaten its neighbors. There is no place on this small planet for a billion of its potentially most able people to live in angry isolation." Even as he launched the opening to China, however, Nixon knew it was a strategic gamble, according to Richard Solomon, a former aide who was involved in the project. But even when he looked back on his strategic initiative 13 years later, Nixon still felt it had been a risk worth taking. "China does not threaten us," he said. Then in October 1989, Nixon made an unpublicized trip to China, where he told Deng Xiaoping and Li Peng, 4 months after the Tiananmen Square massacre and during congressional consideration of sanctions against China, quote, "I am more confident about the future of Sino-American relations than I was in 1972. But just days after that trip, in a personal and confidential memorandum to 6 congressional leaders, Nixon said, quote, "Sino-American relations are in the worst condition they have been in since I went to China 17 years ago. He said the gap in perceptions over Tiananmen is totally unbridgeable. Nevertheless, Nixon asserted Washington and Beijing should follow the example he and Mao set in 1972 and simply put aside irreconcilable differences for the sake of a common front against the Soviet Union, nuclear proliferation, global warming, and even a resurgent Japan. He argued against closing China off from the world using some of the same words he had used in his 1967 article, quote, to leave the present and future leaders of China isolated, nurturing their resentments and even hatred of the United States because of what they consider to be unjustified actions against China is senseless and counterproductive. By the year 2000, however, Nixon confessed to real fears about China's direction. In an interview with his former speechwriter, he was asked whether economic engagement and our strengthening of the Chinese regime had brought political freedom. Nixon's response was a chilling acknowledgment that his visit to China, which he had once proclaimed in his Beijing toast as the week that changed the world, may have changed it for the worse. The article stated, quote, Nixon, that old realist who had played the China card to exploit the split in the communist world, replied with some sadness that he was not as hopeful as he had once been. We may have created a Frankenstein's monster. By contrast, Henry Kissinger, Nixon's partner in the China project, has never confessed to any regrets or second thoughts about the wisdom of engagement and what it has accomplished or not accomplished. As he wrote in the Wall Street Journal just this past weekend, quote, the opening to China was based on an immediate and observable adjustment in Chinese policy, not on an expectation of a fundamental change in China's domestic system. Unfortunately, that immediate and observable adjustment in Chinese policy was supposed to include Beijing's help in arranging an honorable withdrawal from Vietnam. Unfortunately, that never happened. The difference in their later thinking between the two geopolitical realists can be seen most clearly in their views on the future of Taiwan. The ambiguity of the Shanghai communique allowed Beijing to believe the U.S. would eventually acquiesce in China's forcible takeover of Taiwan. But by 1994, Nixon had concluded that history had passed unification by, and Taiwan's democratic course made it an incompatible marriage partner for Beijing. He said then, quote, the situation has changed dramatically. The separation is permanent politically, but they are in bed together economically. But over the ensuing decades, Kissinger, while ostensibly espousing Washington's One China concept, has edged closer to China's unambiguous One China principle that Taiwan belongs to China, period. In a talk before the Asia Society in 2007, he warned Taipei to get on with its political accommodation with Beijing because, quote, China will not wait forever. North Korea presents an interesting case study of the evolution of realist thinking. According to documents in the National Archive, Nixon and Kissinger planned to launch devastating nuclear strikes against North Korea after it downed a U.S. reconnaissance plane flying in international airspace. The plan was scrapped as too dangerous because of likely North Korean retaliation against U.S. bases and allies in the region. 25 years later, when North Korea itself began developing its own nuclear weapons and missiles, initially with Chinese technology acquired through the AQCON network, Kissinger described the prospect as one of the greatest potential catastrophes confronting humanity. As he put it, it would be a world of devastation and human loss without precedent, even in our age of genocidal killing. Yet, while repeatedly arguing that China opposed North Korean nukes as much as the rest of the world, and while acknowledging that it is the only nation with the power to persuade or deter Pyongyang from that course, for the next 20 years, Kissinger offered no less than 8 different explanations of why Beijing tolerated and even enabled the North Korean nuclear and missile programs. Meanwhile, China has effectively played the North Korean card against the U.S., posturing as the reliable and indispensable negotiating partner and responsible international stakeholder, gaining enormous leverage in its other dealings with the U.S. Over the decades, the evidence has mounted that the older Nixon's pessimism and regret were justified. Nixon's original expectations of what change would accomplish in China were badly frustrated by Beijing's skillful management of that change. China's communist leaders certainly followed Nixon's advice in his Foreign Affairs article to focus on domestic development. But they used that progress first to build loyalty to the government that otherwise lacked political legitimacy, and then to finance a massive military buildup that has stirred Chinese nationalism and now intimidates all China's neighbors. Soviet leader Leonid Brezhnev, who knew something about dictatorships, once told Nixon that, quote, Chinese policies would not change even after Mao's death. He was certain that the entire Chinese leadership was instinctively aggressive, unquote. Deng Xiaoping, China's great reformer, dramatically demonstrated the point. While he energetically followed Nixon's advice to open China's economy, he never forgot Mao's teaching that political power grows out of the barrel of a gun in both domestic and international realms. He, quote, taught a lesson to Vietnam in 1978 and to Chinese students in 1989. In the end, it can be argued that China's realists had decisively bested America's leading realists in managing the China-U.S. relationship. We are still living with the consequences of Nixon's week that changed the world. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, now, Peter?
Thank you. My name is Peter Husey, and I'm president of Geostrategic Analysis. I also would like to let you know I'm also senior defense consultant at the Mitchell Institute of the Air Force Association. And if you really want to have a good read, we just published a new book on the need for a new American strategic bomber, which I hope you take a chance to read. You can get it on the website, or you can ask me for that. I think the comments we've just heard from our colleague from CSIS are extraordinarily good and right. And as someone who's been in Washington, D.C. since I came here as an intern in 1970 and 71 in the U.S. Senate, and at that time, you know, we were dealing with some of these issues, I would like to go back to Korea, where I lived as a student at Yonsei University, and one of my professors was a Chinese man named Han Taedong, and he asked me when I was a student, he said, you can type, you're an historian and international relations specialist, and I need someone to help me write a piece, a study for the Ford Foundation, which we're doing for the Nixon administration. And they want to know who's going to win, Mao Zedong or Chou Enlai, Lao Tzu or Confucius. And he said Mao was going to prevail in the Great Cultural Revolution. And this great turmoil in China was something that the United States could play that card by opening China. And this was being done through the Ford Foundation, and I typed the study, and it was in English. And I remember Han Taedong said, don't take the study outside the house because you don't want to be found with it on the street. And it was a fascinating study, but China is seeking leverage. And every place it goes, it seeks leverage, whether building islands throughout the South China Sea, whether telling us not to build a THAAD battery in South Korea. And I'm always puzzled by, if you were sitting in China and you wanted a prosperous Korea on your peninsula to trade with, which they do, why would you tolerate North Korea? Because it's a burden. It costs them money. They do get, yes, labor that they can use in North Korea to produce stuff, but it is leverage for them. If you look at Tom Reed, who was former Deputy National Security Advisor to President Reagan and Secretary of the Air Force under President Ford, he's written a book called The Nuclear Express, express as in a train. And he says nuclear proliferation is like a train hurtling down the tracks and it's not under control. And one of the key engineers on that train is the People's Republic of China and the Khan Network. And that is the danger, that in seeking leverage, they will not be able to control this genie. It's bad enough that they helped create the Khan Network. It's bad enough that they helped with the North Korean nuclear facilities. It's bad enough that they're an ally with Iran, but they're also allies with Venezuela. They're also allies with the Sudan. A lot of that has to do, of course, with oil, which is the other great issue of China. So my concern is that China, in seeking leverage to be kind of one-up on the United States is going to let some genies out of the box that they can't put back in. And that's the danger I see. Thank you.
Thank you. Dave?
And echo the... those are great, great remarks, Joe, and very important. I just have one question for you. And my concern, of course, is with Korean unification. Obviously, China is going to play a big role in whatever happens on the peninsula. But given your expertise and your studying and knowledge, do you think that Taiwan will be used as a bargaining chip in terms of U.S. support to Korea during unification? I mean, will the Taiwan card be played by China in order to engender cooperation with Korean unification? Will China force us to acquiesce in the protection of Taiwan? Is that going to be a have a big role in Korean unification?
So your suggestion is that China would demand that the U.S. in effect abandon Taiwan in exchange for Korean unification,
or at least change policies, reduce maybe not publicly, but some kind of acquiescence in its support to Taiwan in order to engender Chinese support for Korean unification.
My first instinctive reaction, knee-jerk reaction, would be whatever they agree to, they won't comply with it anyway. After all, they did have a strategic agreement with Nixon and Kissinger on Vietnam and the Shanghai communique with its ambiguous statement on Taiwan. And they never comply. They continued supplying arms and weapons to and supplies to the North Vietnamese regime, and they facilitated the eventual humiliation of the U.S. In Vietnam. So their word on any kind of agreement like that, in fact, just the other day, haven't we learned now that they violated the agreements that President Xi made with President Obama on cyber warfare? It's happening already, within days, just as Iran, within days, violated the understandings of its agreement. So, it would certainly have to be an ironclad agreement, but that's only point one, instinctively. But point two is we would never agree to that. The United States is not going to abandon Taiwan under any circumstances. Whatever the rhetoric you hear from some academics about, is this worth the cost, the United States has a moral and geopolitical commitment to Taiwan that will be honored. And I wish we would state that unequivocally instead of pursuing this policy of strategic ambiguity, which persists in allowing China to think, well, maybe there is a chance that they will back out. Maybe there's some way we can get this. We ought to be clear that Taiwan is a core U.S. interest. So,
thank you, Jeff. Tom?
Okay, I listened to Joe's presentation with deep interest. I think it's important for us to remind ourselves of what happened in history. So historic perspective of what happened with respect to the rise of China or the past of China's Chinese development so far. Now, I'd rather like to bring up the latest development in China's role, for example, I'm relating to recent events like Xi Jinping's meeting with South Korean President Park in Pyeongchang, and also then Xi Jinping came over here, met with Obama, then President Park was here just last week. And President Obama said it is compatible for South Korea to have a strong relationship with China as the United States wants to have a strong relationship with China. At the same time, he was saying South Korea should speak when China does not observe international rule or the norm or behaves with impunity on its small and weaker neighbors. And I wanted just to hear what's your point of that, and also when he said the emphasis was on the what might happen in the South China Sea, and South Korea has not said anything, has not spoken out on anything that has developed in the South China Sea. So what is your view on that? And we hear very little from Republican presidential candidates discussing about what might happen, although Donald Trump said North Korea's nuclear program is really dangerous, but nevertheless, nobody's talking about it. We're talking about Iran and ISIS and everywhere else. And Trump says he's going to have a good deal with China, and China would listen to him, his negotiation strategy, and the United States will be better positioned in terms of trade and what have you. What do you make of all this? And in particular, with respect to the policy imperatives for South Korea, because you haven't mentioned, I think, Japan or Japan's role, I think, which we'll cover a little later this afternoon, but what's happening there?
Well, I think it's perfectly appropriate for President Park to develop good relations with all of South Korea's neighbors. Frankly, I wish there would be a little more attention to the relationship between South Korea and Japan, which I think is pivotal to the entire U.S. alliance structure in Northeast Asia. After all, both Japan and South Korea are key U.S. allies in terms of protecting the security of that region. And the fact that two of our closest allies are kind of at odds with each other, and there seems to be greater warmth between President Park and President Xi than there is between her and President Abe, or Prime Minister Abe. So I would like to see a little more attention, and that goes for Japan, too. I think both Japan and South Korea need to bend a little bit more to heal that apparent rift, or at least that coolness that doesn't help the coordination of policy toward China. It seems to me that President Park must realize that the greatest threat to security in the region is coming most specifically from North Korea and vis-a-vis South Korea, but ultimately from China. And I think maybe she thinks a charm offensive will woo Xi and soften his policies, but so far there's no evidence that that's happening. If anything, he believes, it seems, that he is exploiting the relationship to drive a wedge between South Korea and the U.S., and that's a danger, again, a dangerous dynamic leading to potential miscalculation by these leaders. To the extent there can be, obviously, in diplomacy, not everything can be said, but some things need to be said, and that the ambiguities and muddling of the issues lead people like Putin or Xi or the Iranians or other kind of leaders of that ilk to think they can get away with things that ultimately they are not going to be able to get away with without great cost to them and to us.
Do you really believe China is really cooperating with the United States, South Korea, and other members of the six-party talks toward complete denuclearization of North Korea?
No, I do not. I believe they've been playing a game for 20 years that has enabled them to posture, as I said, as the great responsible stake. I mean, compared to North Korea, anyone looks responsible. But China has not been responsible. They have allowed North Korea to pursue these programs. They've defended them, for the most part, at the Security Council. They are always the big brother in the background who ensures that North Korea won't really pay an unacceptable cost for its activities. And so far it's worked.
So you think it's futile for Washington and Seoul to keep emphasizing the role of China's participation and effort to resolve the nuclear issue on the Korean Peninsula?
No, I think they should.
Even latest the joint statement issued by both presidents of Korea and the United States says the same thing, and they have a high expectation of China's role in this regard, but you do not agree.
No, I believe it is important to recognize China's role, but not in a positive light. Mm-hmm. I think we should start emphasizing that China has failed to meet its real responsibilities in the region, and that we expect them to do much more. And beyond that, that they will start paying a price in their own relations with us if they do not cooperate.
Okay, thank you, gentlemen. We have next speaker just arrived. In the meantime, the audience, please hold your questions. We'll make up. Thank you very much, Joe.
Thank you, Joe.
It is my great pleasure to introduce Michael Helen. Come on up. And Mike is another very distinguished thinker in Washington from Brooklyn. All yours.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here. Hi, everybody.
Hello, Michael.
I know you're into a discussion already, and I can see from the representation on this panel that you've already been addressing the topic that I've been asked to speak about, U.S. leadership in the broader region. I don't think, therefore, I need to go over any basics, and certainly this audience gets the basics pretty well, too. So I thought I would actually try to capture some of the ideas with a very specific recommendation or a policy analysis about one particular problem, which I think illustrates the broader role of the United States in Asia, along with our important allies, starting with the ROK in Japan, and of course Australia and others as well. And this is the South China Sea. I know it's a couple thousand miles away from Korea, so I'll be brief in case people want to talk about issues a little closer to the peninsula. But I think it actually is a good case study to illustrate what the American leadership role should be these days in Asia. And as we all know, it's in the news. So I think, again, everybody here is probably fairly well acquainted with the issue. But let me quickly summarize where I see it and then give my suggestion. And I'll try to do all that in about 10 or 12 minutes so we have plenty of time for discussion. Because again, I think this will illustrate essentially the twin goals of strategic reassurance and strategic resolve, which Jim Steinberg and I wrote about last year in our book, which I think are the two focal points or themes the United States needs to try to employ in its regional presence. And the resolve is important for dealing with everyone. The reassurance perhaps is most relevant to dealing with PRC, although clearly elements of reassurance broadly defined are important in dealing with a number of parties, but I take it as a given that the U.S.-ROK relationship, the U.S.-Japan relationship, were already well above the standard that Steinberg and I were aspiring to when we coined the phrase strategic reassurance, which of course is a topic that he had spoken about when he was Deputy Secretary of State in 2009 and gave a speech on that very topic. But our book was designed to flesh out the thinking behind his speech, but also to underscore that there could be no reassurance without resolve. In other words, you could say that we were politely disagreeing with some friends, like maybe Hugh White in Australia, or maybe a few others who argue that the United States would have to pull back or concede hegemony or share hegemony. And in the minds of Jim and myself, the United States has no alternative and should consider no alternative except to maintain very resolute and strong relations with our allies in the region, commitment to our sea lane protection throughout the region, and otherwise, in the hope that China's rise could be steered in a favorable direction, nonetheless, to be willing to push back a little against China where necessary, and hence the competing or really reinforcing and complementary themes of reassurance and resolve, even though they can sound or seem a little bit at tension with each other on first blush. But now let me, again, speak about the South China Sea. And this is not a topic that Jim and I spent a lot of time on in the book. And I've done some further thinking and writing on my own since then. So the concepts of strategic reassurance and resolve are developed together with Steinberg. But what I'm going to say today is my own thinking about the South China Sea. So, as you know, the United States appears to be contemplating a freedom of navigation maneuver in the South China Sea in perhaps coming weeks or months, assuming President Obama approves this and we go forward. And the basic idea here is to respond to China's position, which we find at least partly unacceptable, which is the notion that there is a nine-dash line encompassing most of the South China Sea and within which China really owns everything. That within this nine-dash line, if taken literally, and if interpreted the way some Chinese would have us interpret it, this would essentially attempt to turn the South China Sea into an inland lake of China.
True.
And therefore, the waters would be territorial, all the land formations would be territorial, all the resources would be territorial to China, would be sovereign to China. And therefore, the rest of the world would have to keep its hands off and presumably, in theory, at some point, stay out. And Jim and I find this fundamentally unacceptable. And yet, at the same time, the island reclamation projects of the last few months or a year have introduced a whole new wrinkle. And on this issue, I've tried in my own writing to be a little bit flexible, to be clear on certain points of where I think we need to be resolute and firm towards China, but in other ways where I think we can be flexible and should be flexible, partly because as China rises, it is interested in exercising more influence and clout, and in certain domains, we can accept this. So to be very specific, what I've recommended is that even though I don't like the island reclamation projects and think they are potentially destabilizing and undesirable, I also recognize that China is doing them. And there is no particular international law or treaty commitment that the United States could fall back on to somehow militarily oppose land reclamation. Now, perhaps we should diplomatically oppose it, and we probably, you could say, we have been. We've been objecting to the trend we see, and especially to the notion that now China has far more reclaimed land than anyone else, 3,000 acres worth, that it's built a long runway and perhaps will now station some military aircraft on that runway, even though President Xi, when he was visiting Washington last month, said there would be no militarization of these islands. But that has now led to a whole new round of sort of tea leaf reading about what he meant, since in some sense the islands are already militarized because they were essentially populated very quickly with some PLA infrastructure. And so the question is, how far will this go and what can we do about it? So my basic argument, in keeping with these twin notions of reassurance and resolve, has been to say, listen, one or two of these islands, or even a few, in some ways are the equivalent of American aircraft carriers in the South China Sea. Now, not everyone's going to accept that analogy, but to me, it would be difficult for the United States to really get upset about a reclaimed island or two or three, when in fact we send our own mobile aircraft carriers 8,000 miles away from our own shores and act as if we should have free access in the South China Sea. And in fact, we should. We should have free access. So should everyone else, because these are international waters, and there's a well-developed body of international law, not just the Law of the Sea Convention, but even precedent going farther back many decades and centuries, that would say these kinds of waters are open to the commercial ships, recreational ships, and warships of any country that chooses to use the international waterways. And we should be firm about that. But by the same token, even though there is not such a long-standing body of law that would justify the reclamation of land formations or sandbars or shoals and allow a state to justify them and being turned into islands, there's no international law of the sandbar convention that says you can go ahead and take any of these you want and just pile sand on and then put military assets. In another sense, I'm not sure that we can make a very strong objection, provided that several conditions are met. And this is where, again, I sort of try to strike a balance. One condition is China should be modest in the pace of its military buildup. We have an Asia-Pacific rebalance policy, and it is a modest policy. In fact, in some ways, all we're trying to do is get back to the force levels of the 1990s in terms of the number of Navy ships positioned, based, deployed in the broader Asia-Pacific region. That's the extent of what the Asia-Pacific rebalance amounts to in military terms. The new initiatives here and there on land, a couple thousand Marines training in Australia at a time, a few littoral combat ships rotating through Singapore, a couple things like that with Guam and Japan as well. These are very modest, and collectively, they are probably less in their magnitude than the fact that we pulled 10,000 U.S. forces out of Korea over the last 15 years. So at best, we are keeping our land presence about numerically equal to what it had been. We're increasing our fleet in the region back to what it was in the 1990s. This is not a big buildup. The next American president may decide to escalate or accelerate the pace of that buildup a little further, but whether it's a Republican or a Democrat, I would predict that the pace of that buildup will not be all that fast, and it will not be all that particularly notable compared with China's own buildup, which of course is happening at the rate of roughly 10% a year in military spending terms. So my suggestion to China would be, if you're going to reclaim an island or two, if you're going to put some military assets in the region, the buildup should be modest and it should be transparent. And then if you want to have a few airplanes there, we Americans really shouldn't object, because on any given day we might have 72 airplanes there ourselves flying off an aircraft carrier, and maybe a few more flying from Guam or from Okinawa or what have you on a long-range surveillance mission. So as long as the pace is modest and some of the missions are defined as supporting international norms, freedom of navigation, maybe counter-piracy, maybe some humanitarian search and rescue, missions like that that have a legitimate basis in international law, the United States should be, frankly, willing to accept that China does some of this. And probably we could back off some of our criticism a little bit. On the other hand, the notion that China has any right to a nine-dash line is somewhere between ridiculous and extremely threatening. And we should be very clear on this. The only reason today why most people don't use words as strong as I just did is because China's not trying to enforce that. But the actual claim is incredibly dangerous if taken literally. And we have to make it clear to China that their presence in the South China Sea in military terms is, of course, understandable and perhaps symmetrical or parallel to our own, but their claim of a nine-dash line cannot be. Two last points and I'll finish. What this means then, or maybe three points, what this means is these reclaimed islands cannot have territorial waters associated with them. They are not legitimate islands. They do not have legitimate standing under the Law of the Sea Convention, and therefore they cannot have a 12-mile range of sea around them, which is the sovereign territory of China. There will be no such recognition. There should be no such recognition. That would be point number one. Point number two is, therefore, the United States Navy can and must sail within 12 miles of some of these formations. Now, we can do it in all sorts of nice ways. We should do it safely. We should treat those islands as if they're stationary ships. We should give them a couple miles leeway. We shouldn't come right up to the edge. We shouldn't try to buzz the islands with low, like Tom Cruise, low flight, flyovers like in Top Gun. We shouldn't try to stoke tensions. And maybe even some of our ships could occasionally just be an oiler or a resupply vessel. Just to make the point to China, almost matter-of-factly, we know you're not going to shoot at us. You have no reason to shoot at us. You better not shoot at us. We're just going to use these waters as we always have. So that would be my second concluding point. But my third point, and again, on this one, I'm trying to also be flexible and to reassure. If the Chinese think that because of their proximity to the South China Sea and their history with it and their own size as a nation, that they should in some sense be the first among equals in developing the economic resources of the South China Sea region, and if they can persuade other regional countries to go along with that sort of an arrangement, I think we Americans can accept that. So one, this is very notional and very theoretical at this point, but let's imagine there are economic resources on the seabed in the South China Sea. Hypothetically, I would be fine if the regional states, including Vietnam, the Philippines, and China, developed a consortium arrangement, essentially a mutual investment company, in which China had 51% of the total shares. Fine with me, as long as they put in, as long as they convince the other countries in the region that that's fair, and presumably put in 51% of the capital to invest, to develop the resources. And I'm making up the number 51%. I'm simply trying to say that for an American, we don't have to get into the issue of whether this area needs to be completely equally shared or whether the formula for sharing resources should be related to the coastline, the length of the coastline of each country, or the number of archipelago islands nearby. I don't think we have to get into that. And I can acknowledge why the Chinese might feel that they should have a little bit of a special role. And perhaps they also have more capital than the other countries. And so to the extent that you need to invest money to develop the resources, and the other countries are happy giving China a little bit greater stake because it has deeper pockets, that sort of thing would be fine. I don't think we should try to object to that either. So on economic development, on reclamation itself, on some limited militarization of those reclaimed islands, I think we have to be flexible. Doesn't mean we have to like it, but we can be flexible as Americans. On the nine-dash line and on territorial waters and on freedom of navigation, however, the Chinese need to know that we cannot and will not be flexible. And that's the policy, which is a little different from where we are today in the U.S. government, because we seem to object sort of equally to everything. And I think it's important to be a little bit more clear on what we really find unacceptable and where we can try to adapt, as long as China pursues its interests in a peaceful way, ultimately through negotiation with other countries where that's necessary. So I think I'll stop there and look forward to the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. Okay, Mike. It's very interesting. The floor is open, but before I do that, Joe, he was talking about South China Sea, all this international law. You are the only lawyer in this line, so what do you think?
Two. I think Michael gave his usual very thoughtful and incisive presentation. I've enjoyed listening to him for, I was going to say years, it's probably decades by now, even though he doesn't look a day older. But
neither do you, my friend.
He's always very wise and perspicacious. One question I have, though, Michael, I certainly agree with your statement about the unacceptability of the nine-dash line, and I think you said as long as China doesn't seek to implement it. But in fact, this island reclamation project is an implementation of the nine-dash line. Step by step, they are proceeding to demonstrate their claim to the entire South China Sea. And when you say, okay, we can let you have a little, but not a lot, and you've got to be moderate, and you can't, you know, take it too far, it's kind of a fuzzy line, and they're very good at exploiting fuzzy lines. At what point would we say, wait a minute, you've now got 24 aircraft there, before you had 4, what are we going to do about it? So they keep pushing the line, that seems to me. I think there's language in the United Nations Law of the Sea Convention that prohibits precisely what they're already doing. Exactly. I think it prohibits building up, making artificial islands out of rocks and reefs. So I think that there is a line already in the international law regime, and I think we should stick to that line and complain frequently and strongly that what they've already done and what they're doing is unacceptable under international law.
Okay, Colin, please, Mike.
Well, that's a great point, and thank you, Joe, because I think it does help highlight some of the issues. First of all, of course, as we're all aware, if there is such a provision, and I should know, but if there is, let's assume there is such a provision in the Convention on the Law of the Sea, that's, of course, a convention to which we are not legally bound and have not legally supported. So we're in a little bit of a tough spot to base our entire claim on that. Customary international law, however, has allowed for the freedom of navigation, as you well know, for decades and centuries, separate from the Convention on the Law of the Sea. So I think our standing on that point is a little firmer. So even if we want to object to the reclamation efforts, I think we should, in a sense, object with a little less stridency. Now, as for, the Chinese are not the only ones who have occupied islands. Now, they've built them up, and others have not done anything to that same scale. And so I don't know that there is a threshold. You're right to sort of point out that my approach is ambiguous, because it doesn't say at what point what China's done is too much, and therefore it invites them to keep pushing the limit. And I would concede your point. I'm afraid that's a dilemma that I can't see a way around. But what I would suggest is the following, okay? Right now, the United States on any given day might have 72 airplanes in the South China Sea, or we might have zero. I'd be curious to see a statistical average, but it's somewhere probably around 30 or 40 for how often our aircraft carriers are there, or large deck amphibious ships, which can carry a couple dozen airplanes each, as you know. So as China gets up to that kind of a number, then they, and if they show any interest in surpassing it, then we can, I think, be even more emphatic. Even if they want to approach our presence, I think they have to, they should be held to some degree of explanation about what they're trying to do with those capabilities, because we have been fairly unambiguously, at least since the Vietnam War, a force for nothing but peace in the South China Sea. And I don't know of any parties that are objecting to our presence in a strident way or in a, you know, concerted way. Whereas China, of course, is trying to exercise greater claims to disputed land areas and sea areas. And so for China to approach parity with the United States would itself be concerning. And I think we could base our argument on this strategic reality that, in fact, China is sort of an irredentist power in the South China Sea, whereas we are trying to protect international norms and the global commons. My guess is that most South China Sea countries would probably side with us. And I guess that's got to be the crux of my argument, that to the extent that there are signs that China's really pushed this too far, it's going to be the clear objections by ASEAN and, at some point, the UN Security Council, I would hope, that will be our strongest allies. And that our ability to sustain the argument will be partly a function of when everyone else is equally nervous as we feel. And our, you know, the strength of our objections will grow to the extent they become increasingly unanimous within the region and the broader international community. That's not a very good answer to your, I acknowledge. It doesn't say at what point China's gone too far. But I think it's politically realistic. Whereas I think if we say that every single acre that they reclaim now is quote unquote unacceptable, I don't know that we really have a strong enough leg to stand on to sustain that claim in the court of international public opinion.
Thank you, Mike. Joe, would you follow up comment?
Just one point that is minor in one sense, but significant in another, and that is when you, I think you said just now that the U.S. doesn't support the Law of the Sea Convention. I think although we're not a signatory to it, or we haven't ratified it, we have showed greater allegiance to the Law of the Sea Convention, because it's based on customary international law, than China has, which is a signatory. So I think, in fairness, the U.S. has honored the spirit of the UNCLOS and really the letter of it as well.
Thank you, Joe. Peter?
Michael, thanks for your comments. I'm reminded there is a problem in feeding the fox a few chickens from the chicken coop and saying that's enough. Mm-hmm. The fox gets to vote. And my concern is when you look at Mike Pillsbury's new book about the 100-year hegemon, there is a reason China is doing this. If it was just developing oil and gas, I could even understand it. But my concern is this, Michael, as David Fife in the Wall Street Journal wrote last month, or last week, they're trying to make, as Joe said, an inland waterway out of 1.35 million square miles through which $5 trillion of goods travel in any one year. That's the trade. And my question, and I don't have an answer to this, is that because Pillsbury, if you read his book, it's mainly economic hegemony. The question is, what is China up to in your view that it would be injurious to? Because if they're in the business of saying we're just trying to protect navigation, freely operating, who's in the business of stopping navigation? I know the Chinese are very concerned that the Persian Gulf oil would be stopped by a country like India. And they've even alluded that we would stop it, and so there's one of their concerns. But I'm not quite sure, are they thinking of countering the United States, stopping trade to China as a lever? Or are they in the business of seeking to control trade that goes to some of the region? That to me is the question I'd like to see if you can, I don't know the answer to that. I'm curious how you think they're thinking on this.
Well, it's an excellent point and question as well, Peter. And I think I would make a couple of responses. One is, It's possible that the Chinese are the fox having a couple of chickens now and looking to have 20 later. I can't rule it out based on behavior so far. But it's also possible that it's the fox that's just a little bit hungry and now has its talons sharp enough to grab a couple of chickens. I know it's probably a metaphor I shouldn't use too much longer, but what I'm trying to say is that rising powers through history, including the United States, although I think our rise was pretty beneficial to the world in general, but and probably unprecedented in that spirit. But rising powers historically have wanted to flex their muscles a bit, and I think we should recognize that in some sense as an historical inevitability and try to channel China's behavior in relatively more benign directions. Second point is that I think we too should play the long game. I give Pillsbury credit. He's thinking in long-term time horizons. And what I'm trying to do is not just be nice to China and say, okay, here's a few things we can tolerate as long as you don't do any more, but to also set up some standards and to set up some canaries in the coal mine so that if they exceed what could be seen as a reasonable military presence in the region and are in pursuit of outright hegemony or the enforcement of the nine-dash line, that we have set up the legal and strategic predicate so that the world in general can come after them at that point. And that we will have most of the region, most of the world with us because we had made efforts to look for what could be seen as reasonable compromises, not just holding everything that we used to have back in the old days when China was too weak to do anything about it, but reasonable compromises that allowed China to exercise greater prerogatives as long as they didn't come at the direct expense of anyone else or through the use of violence. And then if China exceeds those reasonable standards and compromises, then we have laid down the predicate to object more in the future. So I guess that's the essence of what I'm trying to lay out.
Is this some kind of red line when you say standard?
Well, that's the problem, is that the standards here are not, at least as I see them, not as simply defined. But I would submit, and this is probably something for future writing and discussion and diplomacy, that as China seems to approach parity, that would be one problematic line, not quite a red line, but certainly a line. And then if they seem to pursue superiority, that would be yet another line. And perhaps at that point, we need to start talking more with the Philippines and Vietnam about land bases for American combat aircraft so that we can respond in kind. And I don't know, maybe we should even respond before China gets to parity, but I'm not overly worried until they start to approach parity.
Thank you, Mike. Dave?
Yes, Michael, thank you for your remarks. And I'd like to shift to more firmer ground, and I hope you'll indulge me because I'd like to ask a question that's not really connected to your remarks, but connected to your most recent book that's getting a lot of notoriety about the continued importance of ground forces. And I only was able to read the first chapter, which you mentioned Korea quite a bit from a historical perspective. But given the reduction in ground forces in the United States, and you also mentioned the reduction of forces, U.S. forces in Korea over the last 15 years, and then the declining, the demographic impact on the ROC Army, and that they're not going to be able to maintain 650,000 forces. I wonder if from your research and your book, if you have any comments you could make about ground forces in Korea, the future of ground forces, and most importantly, the importance of ground forces. Stating my bias right there.
Well, no, thank you. And you also have, bias is, of course, not the right word, specialization and concern about Korea, which is very appropriate for this crowd. And also, we're all grateful to you for your focus on this crucial alliance and part of the world over the years. I've learned a lot from reading you. I think I would say just a couple of things. One is that, I guess the central point is that the United States, in its war planning, needs to be as committed to Korea in the future as we have been in the past to first approximation. That's the central point. There are a number of Americans who are saying that we don't have to do as much in the future because the ROK is such a success. It's an economic and industrial and high technology and manufacturing success and a great political success. It's larger than North Korea. Whatever its problems with demographic trends, its problems are certainly a lot better than the problems faced by North Korea writ large with all of its economic malaise and its much smaller population and economic base. So there are people who will argue that whatever the war plans currently say, the 5027 or 5029 war plans or what have you, that if the United States was assumed to be providing, you know, 400 or 500,000 total military personnel or even 600,000 in a previous version of one of those war plans, maybe we can cut that number in half today or reduce it by a third. I don't agree. I am not one of those people. You mentioned a very specific concern within the South Korean Army, and that's one very specific and useful concern to bear in mind. But I would also, and I'm sure you would as well, think about things such as the North Korean nuclear weapons capability, North Korean rocket forces. And if I imagine a future Korean contingency, it's going to be crucially important, not just for the defense and safety of Seoul, but for the safety of the Western alliance system and the United States, to stop this violence fast and to get our hands on the weapons of mass destruction inside of North Korea fast. And I would actually welcome Chinese help in some of that, partly because I think the Chinese, as I've written elsewhere, would probably intervene in this kind of a war anyway, whether we ask them to or not. South Korea may have the ability to persuade them not to come in, but you may even want them to. In any event, I don't think the United States has the standing to keep China out of at least the northern parts of North Korea in a future contingency. And with apologies, I think most people in this room know how we defense planners think. We immediately launch into a discussion of being in the middle of a wartime scenario on a very otherwise nice fall afternoon, and it's a little shocking. So, but Dave certainly gets what I'm driving at, and I think most of you do too. So I'm not predicting this kind of a conflict. I'm not advocating it by any means, but I'm recognizing the possibility. And therefore, for American force planning and for Combined Forces Command force planning, I believe that the United States needs to be able to deploy not only high technology, you know, aircraft with laser-guided bombs to shoot at long-range artillery launchers and missile launchers, but also that we need to have ground forces, maneuver forces, that can help the ROK in this sort of a scenario very quickly consolidate control over those parts of North Korea that may still be threatening to Seoul and also that may have nuclear weapons within them. And let me finish on one of my pet peeves. Dave probably knows where I'm going already. This is one reason why I am totally against operational transfer of control and command and control or the dissolution of CFC. It's one of these things where I don't think the interesting debate is whether we should do it in 2012 or 2015 or 2018. It's just a bad idea. With all due respect to those who are in favor of it, it's just a bad idea to complicate the unity and simplicity of command when you face a real threat. And I would much rather aspire to the day when the ROK and the United States can alternate which general is the top general, but keep everything else. That's the way I look at it, partly because I do take this threat so seriously. And I think that, again, pervades everything about our defense planning, or at least it should, including the size of the American forces we may need to devote to this kind of a scenario, as well as the, you know, unity of command that the alliance should sustain.
Thank you, Mike. Tom, do you have a quick comment, please?
Yes. I want to go back to South China Sea. I think you really presented very interesting and very specific proposal with respect to possible resolution of the situation or de-conflicting possible collusion between U.S. and Chinese or some other players in the region. Now, the question here is, of course, we already discussed so much about it, that is, how much is it too much, but what the United States, I mean, administration has so far advocated on or asked for is the freedom of navigation over flights for trade and commercial purposes, and I mean, administration, as we discussed, is not a signatory to the law of the sea, but nevertheless, they said they abide by the law of the sea, and that's the spirit. But question is, where do you think the United States will find a source of leadership to intervene in South China Sea? There are all kinds of you know, conferences and meetings going on between Beijing and Washington. For example, my question is, would military-to-military talks should include a subject on de-conflicting of a possible clashes in the region, such as, I mean, as you said, there is no international law Which country can or cannot develop or reclaim on rocks and reefs and whatnot. There is no such law. The law of the sea does not, as far as I know, it doesn't really specifically deal with such situations as you alluded to it. Now, I mean, there's no law, for example, on cyber, international law on cybersecurity, for example. There's a lot of new developments, and as the world gets more complicated, and as China grows, these problems come together with China's growth. Now, that reminded me, some of the things you discussed reminded me of at the turn of the century, last century, 1910, was it? The United States and Japan had a Navy-to-Navy talk and discussing how many ships you can have and how many ships we're going to have and so forth. Are you suggesting some kind of, if you compare, say, efficacy or capability of what China can do from this reclaimed island, comparable to an aircraft carrier, as you comparison, would they discuss more specifically, okay, you do this? I mean, what they have reclaimed and built military capabilities on the island already, we are not asking China. United States is not asking China to destroy them. It's there already. What we're saying is do not continue with the construction. That's all we say. And resolve the issue according to international law of the sea. China says it's inheritance from our ancestors 1,000 years ago. So we're not going to. This is a matter of our core of territorial sovereignty interests. We're not going to give up upon this. So there's no way that China will say, okay, you are right. So we're going to just stop. We're going to withdraw from here. We're going to let everybody else do whatever they want to do as before. That's not going to happen. So your idea is very interesting, that whether they not going modestly and transparency, two things you said, but transparency we can push on, has always asked China to be transparent on military planning or military budget spendings and so forth. That hasn't changed, but that has not influenced China from stopped China from doing any of these things. So my question is, what specific ideas? You talked about some other things about the economic development and so forth. I think that's very reasonable. But militarily, security-wise, what the United States and China can sit down? I mean, they have all kinds of dialogues nowadays, you know. But we don't hear any specific ideas as your proposal, for example. You know, how much is modest, we would think? And in the meantime, we have access to international sea. We're going to put our aircraft carrier there, and we're going to station it there, or we're going to just let it visit, you know, so many times, so months, and so forth. You think this kind of specific agreement can be subject to discussion between the two countries?
Thank you, kind sir, for the question. Well, you might be asking a little too much of military-to-military dialogue, I think, for that, for the militaries to solve this on their own. Because, as I think most of us would agree, including perhaps Peter and Joe, I don't want to put words in their mouth, but even those who have been, you know, concerned about whether my proposal is too conciliatory or that it could be interpreted by China in that way, I think we are generally in agreement that China's flexing its muscles, and I would say in ways that China hasn't quite figured out exactly what grand strategy they're implementing or pursuing. I don't think China has a clear vision. Michael Pillsbury's laid out one concept that's probably what some Chinese think. Other Chinese are probably being pragmatic and seeing what they can get away with or what resources are required to pursue various goals. And so I don't think there is a way for the military, which is ultimately an arm of the party and the state, to make that kind of a decision on its own. And also when you refer back to the Washington Naval Treaty, as we all know, that historically has been seen as a failure, because what it did was it encouraged people to channel their military modernization in areas they could get away with. And the treaty wound up only constraining certain areas of military modernization, not others. And so if you try to do that and you're overly precise and overly formulaic, I think you wind up causing yourself more troubles than you solve. So what I would submit is that we state some principles. And one principle is anybody who wants to increase their military holdings and deployments in the South China Sea, they should be explaining how that serves international law and the common good. And they should connect their plans, their activities, their aspirations for increasing those things to their theory of how this serves the common good. And if they can't do that, that is one more marker that we can then use to criticize China. And so I may be sounding like the dove on the panel, but I'm the dove that's anticipating that we may need to get tougher with China down the road, and I want to establish some predicates to allow us to do so. So, however, I don't think it's feasible to just say to China, why don't we each have 30 airplanes at a time in the South China Sea? As soon as you say that, then all the American airplanes are going to be B-2 bombers, and all the Chinese airplanes are going to be, you know, their equivalent once they can do it. In other words, if you do a quantitative limit, then you encourage qualitative modernization. And so it's not really worth trying to be that binding. It's more important to say what I did earlier, that especially if China pursues some kind of parity with American capabilities, which historically have been in the service of the common good in the South China Sea, China needs to explain what it's up to. And if it doesn't, we're going to have to start to assume maybe potentially malevolent or competitive intent.
Just one thing, very quickly, Joe.
Michael, how would you treat the interests of other countries, other claimants in the region? Would they also be allowed to match the number of aircraft that the U.S. or that China has flying?
Well, again, I'm not necessarily trying to propose a strict arms control treaty, but I think that, you know, first of all, I would love it if other countries would do more, because it would help create more legitimacy for the notion that as long as you're upholding the common good and the sea lanes and equal access to them, that patrols in general down here are a good thing. And, you know, I think any country that was capable of matching us would be pretty impressive. And so I'm not so sure that there is any other country that we need to think about in that domain. But I would welcome seeing India occasionally present, Japan. Maybe Japan and China can do patrols together. Why don't I leave on that somewhat semi-facetious note? But I'm not really kidding. This is a place where countries that otherwise have competitive claims or relationships can find a way to cooperate, because in the end, we should all be about protecting the sea lanes.
Thank you very much, Mike. With that understanding, let's give Mike a big round of applause. Thank you, Mike.
Thanks, everybody.
Are you leaving now?
Yeah.
Okay, I have something for you, Mike.
Kind of you. Can't leave without the
Mike. This is from Philadelphia.
Oh, very kind.
Cherry. Look at this token on Philadelphia Spirit.
Thanks, Mike. Thank you, sir.
I'll write you.
Okay.
See you, Mike.
All right. Now, our next speaker is the Honorable Ambassador Juno from the United Nations. Daniel Ohm will introduce the ambassador.
Thank you, Dr. Kim, for this opportunity to introduce the distinguished ambassador. Ambassador Chun Oh is the permanent representative of the Republic of Korea to the United Nations. Ambassador Oh comes to us today with a distinguished and storied career in public service. He joined the Korean Ministry of Foreign Affairs in 1978 and has served in leadership posts in a variety of settings, including in Latin America, Southeast Asia, and the United Nations. Currently, in his role as permanent representative of the Republic of Korea to the UN, he serves as the president of the Economic and Social Council, which began in July of 2015. In addition, he serves as the president of the Conference of States Parties, the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. During the Republic of Korea's term on the Security Council in 2013 through 14, he served as president of the Security Council in May of 2014. And those watchers would be hard-pressed to forget the ambassador's remarkable comments for the vote for the landmark resolution where they presented North Korea human rights situation on the Security Council's agenda for the very first time. If you haven't seen it, I urge you to watch it. It's available online and free. The Republic of Korea awarded Ambassador Oh an Order of Service Merit twice, which includes the Order of Green Stripes in 1996, and the Order of Yellow Stripes in 2006. Ambassador Oh received a master's degree in international policy studies from Stanford University, where he was also a visiting scholar at the Hoover Institution. a diploma in international and comparative politics from the London School of Economics and Political Science, and a bachelor's in French literature from Seoul National University. Ambassador, it's our privilege and honor to have you. Please join me in welcoming Ambassador Oh.
Okay, you can use this. I don't know how to use this.
Press the right button.
Oh, it's there.
Oh, this one.
Oh, I can see that one, and yeah. I think they can watch the one on the side. Well, thank you very much. That was the introduction was way too kind. I didn't know I was holding that many positions right now, but thanks for reminding me. And thank you very much, Dr. Kim, Madam Kim, and all those at ICAS for inviting me here. I never been to this this world famous institute, Heritage Foundation. Not because I'm liberal, but I don't come to Washington D.C. too often. I have been posted in New York 3 times before, so this is my 4th posting in New York City. But I come up here from time to time, actually. But last year, because I'm serving as a president of ECOSOC, and ECOSOC of the United Nations, we have our annual dialogue with Bretton Woods institutions like World Bank and IMF, so we come up here at least once a year. And I just had lunch with Ambassador An Ho-young, my good old friend, and not that we are old, but a long-standing friend. Yeah. Well, thank you, and I was going to ask if there is any Chatham House rule applied here, but I noticing the cameras rolling, I think so much for the Chatham House rules, but I will try to be prudent in my remarks. And thank God I'm using PowerPoint, you know, try to make my presentation not as boring as it usually is. I have to watch that one. I know that today's meetings are all about the Korean Peninsula issues, and because I'm Korean ambassador to the United Nations, I thought I might give you another angle by presenting the Korean Peninsula issues in the United Nations. You know, Korea has a lot to do with the United Nations, and looking back on what happened in the United Nations and also what is happening right now and what's going to happen in the future, I think might help you understand the Korean Peninsula issues a little better. I will give you a rundown on history of the issues in the UN and also the current discussion as well as future prospects. If I may start with the with what happened in the past, the Korea got independence in 1945 after 36 years of Japanese colonial rule, and in 1948 we established our government in South Korea, and so did North Koreans, but somehow the elections in South Korea were supervised. I think there is a little mistype for overseas, not that. But anyway, the elections in South Korea were only supervised by the United Nations, and the UN was not able to do anything in North Korea, where the Soviet troops came in while American troops came into South Korea. So we all know that. And in 1950, only 2 years after the establishment of governments in South Korea and North Korea, the Korean War broke out. As you know, the North Korean troops marched into South, and the war lasted 3 years. And right after the war, the Security Council adopted a resolution to authorize what was called a unified command under the U.S. command, and also let them use the flag of the United Nations. That's how the UN flag is still flying in South Korea. This was, in a way, possible because the Soviet Union was boycotting the Security Council meetings those days. You know, as you know, the five permanent members, they all have a veto power, so they can always individually block whatever agreement they don't like. But the Soviet Union was boycotting the Security Council those days, so the Security Council was able to pass this resolution. But they came back, so the Korean question was brought to the General Assembly because the Soviet Union came back and they started to use veto. So in the General Assembly, they went for this action called Uniting for Peace, under which they gave further instructions to the Unified Command in Korea during the Korean War. And General Assembly created the UN Commission for the Unification and Rehabilitation of Korea, which was called UNCIRC. The war ended, and under the agenda item, the Korean question, UNCIRC's report was submitted annually and discussed in the General Assembly. So the Korean question was officially on the agenda of the General Assembly since the end of the war, 1954. Through 1975, that means about 20 years. Each year, the supporters of South Korea, ROK, were able to pass resolution. And they were, of course, supporters of North Korea, but they were small in number. So their resolution was consistently turned down until 1975. After 1970s, more non-aligned countries, mostly small and newly independent countries became members of the United Nations. So it was more difficult for Western powers to control what is happening in the UN. And in 1975, two contradictory resolutions on Korea were passed. So it was not possible to implement those two resolutions because they were saying different things on the same thing. So that sort of demonstrated the pointlessness of the debate in the General Assembly. So they decided to remove the item from the agenda from 1976. And after that, there was no Korean question in the UN. But South Korea and North Korea were competing diplomatically, and South Korea was doing better because as of 1991, South Korea had diplomatic ties with 152 countries, while North Korea had only 121. And South Korea wanted to become a UN member, but North Korea didn't agree. They argued that Korea should be a UN member as a one nation after unification. Unification never came. So in 1991, when the Cold War ended, South Korea, we applied for UN membership again. And North Korea's protectors, like Soviet Union and China, thought they were no longer able to block South Korea's entry into the UN. So they advised North Korea to do the same, so the two Koreas became UN members simultaneously in 1991. From 1991 to today, The Korean question, Korean Peninsula questions came back in the form of North Korean issues, because they were no longer South Korean issue. The DPRK's case came back to the UN Security Council when there was the first round of North Korean nuclear crisis in 1993, when they kicked out IAEA inspectors from North Korea, and there was a strong suspicion of their nuclear weapon development. So the United Nations Security Council picked it up. It's a threat to peace and security. And they passed a resolution in 1991. But after that, what was called the Geneva Agreement, Geneva Framework, if you like, in 1994, looked like settling the issue. Actually, they settled the issue as of those times, you know. But basically, the deal was, as you would recall, United States, South Korea, and Japan would build a couple of nuclear reactors in North Korea in return for North Korea's giving up of nuclear weapons. It was the deal was being implemented until 2002, but it broke down. I think it's going to come up a little later. But North Korea conducted its first round of nuclear bomb test in 2006, and after that, as you can see, the Security Council resolutions each time strengthening sanctions were adopted almost every other year. So nuclear and missile issues is the first issue, the first Korean Peninsula issue that came back to the United Nations after the end of the Cold War. And due to the Security Council sanctions, right now the DPRK remains one of the countries that are under very comprehensive sanctions regimes. Not only they are under arms embargo, but also they are under what is called luxury goods ban. You know, luxury goods are not related to arms or weapons. Luxury goods are like expensive wine or luxury cars like Mercedes. But countries are not supposed to export those things to North Korea, because North Korean leadership might be using or misusing them to bribe their own elite group officials. So that's why luxury goods ban is there. And last time when I was giving a press conference, someone asked me what's gonna happen if North Korea goes for another round of provocation, like a long-range missile or nuclear bomb test. So I said, the sanctions will be strengthened. So how strengthened? So I said, it's gonna be strengthened both in terms of weapons-related embargo and embargo not related to weapons as well. So they said, oh, that's new thing. You know, North Korea is only under weapons-related embargo. But that's not true. North Korea is actually under luxury goods ban also. Luxury goods have nothing to do with the weapons, but it's still there. So the scope of sanctions can be expanded if North Korea goes for another round of provocation. Also, the existing list of sanctions can be further expanded. And actually, there have been a couple of cases which prove that the sanctions work. Those are the cases of Chongcheonggang and Mudbong. Chongcheonggang is a North Korean ship captured in Panama Canal, because they were carrying weapons or parts of weapons from Cuba to North Korea. Mudbong was captured by Mexico last year. It didn't have weapons on it, but Mudbong's owner was the same shipping company which owned Chongcheonggang. And after Chongcheonggang case, the Security Council expanded the list of companies sanctioned, North Korean company sanctions, and that particular shipping company was included. So all those ships owned by that shipping company is called OMM. So all those ships owned by OMM got under sanctions. So that's how Mexico captured Mudbong and is still holding it there. Human rights issue is the number two issue of the Korean Peninsula issue, otherwise DPRK issues that came back to the United Nations in post-Cold War era. North Korea's human rights situation became known outside North Korea only around late 1990s. Probably the situation had been bad even before that, but there was not, we didn't have too many sources of information from North Korea, but North Korean defectors started to come out. North Korean workers started to come out in the 1990s. So we realized how bad the North Korean human rights situation was. And then in 2003, one of the United Nations human rights arm, Human Rights Council, it was not called Human Rights Council at the time, it was called Human Rights Commission. But anyway, today it's called Human Rights Council. They started to adopt annual resolution on DPRK, human rights. And General Assembly started that in 2005. Human Rights Council is in Geneva, General Assembly is in New York. And they appointed a special rapporteur on DPRK human rights. And right now it's an Indonesian gentleman named Darusman. Last year was, in a way, historic year in terms of debate on North Korean human rights, because thanks to the gentleman on the photo holding the report, his name is Mr. Kirby, and he is former Australian justice. He and other two people formed a commission of inquiry, and they worked about a year and came out with a report that is most comprehensive and in-depth ever on North Korea's human rights issues. It was a 400-page report, and the importance of the report was not its volume, but the fact that they described the North Korean human rights violation as crimes against humanity. Crimes against humanity is not rhetoric. It's a legal term used in the United Nations and international law when you describe certain crimes like war crimes. So when it falls into crimes against humanity, it qualifies for ICC referral. ICC is International Criminal Court. The United States is not yet a state party to the court, but the court has almost 150 state parties and is becoming more and more influential these days, because there have been cases of heads of state being referred to the court for their crimes, like war crimes, crimes against humanity. genocide crimes. So in that sense, the report was very important. And last year, the UN General Assembly adopted a resolution to encourage Security Council to consider the COI recommendation, including the Council's debate on the DPRK human rights situation. And thanks to that, they did it in December last year. I was, that's me speaking to the Security Council on North Korea's human rights. And earlier, kindly introduced by him. And the third case or area where the DPRK or Korean Peninsula issue is on the agenda of the United Nations currently is the field of humanitarian assistance. As we know, North Korea has a lot of difficulty in its economy, and it is probably one of the least developed countries in the world. So as you see in the quotation from OCHA, OCHA is Office of Humanitarian Assistance, and they are saying DPRK is highly food insecure country with a population made increasingly vulnerable by continued reliance upon unreliable food supplies. So that's how it is. And the international community is providing humanitarian assistance. The problem is the volume of humanitarian assistance provided to North Korea is going down because North Korea is under sanctions. Not too many donors are willing to provide a donation. Even though they know it's for humanitarian purpose, they try to be very careful. So it's very hard for the United Nations to meet the relief goal set for North Korea every year. And many people, probably not too many people know that South Korea still remains number one donor when it comes to humanitarian assistance to North Korea. So if you look at the figure last year, there was a total of $48 million provided to North Korea in humanitarian assistance, and South Korea accounted for $13 million out of it. So almost 30% came from South Korea. And that does not include our civil society donation, which was about $6 million. Humanitarian assistance is still going on. Even this year, there was a serious drought in North Korea, and the UN came up. So the Secretary General had to use what is called the UN Central Emergency Response Fund, SERF, because there was not sufficient donations from member states. So UN Secretary General is entitled to use that emergency response fund when there's not enough money, which he did. So I will discuss briefly what I think is going to happen. In terms of DPRK, nuclear missile issues, so security area, we all know that the six-party talks have been suspended for 7 years. The last meeting was held in 2008. 2006, there was a good enough deal agreement in the six-party talks, but it was not implemented, you know. So there's no talks. And by now, I think a lot of people have doubts or skepticism about whether the DPRK has ever been willing to give up nuclear weapons in return for anything through negotiations. In the beginning, opinion was divided. some people thought probably North Korea's nuclear weapons was a bargaining chip. You know, they just want to have more aid, more recognition. And so they didn't really mean to develop nuclear weapons, but they wanted to use it as bargaining chip. So that was a good enough argument in the beginning. But now I think nobody is arguing that, you know, because they look like they are determined to have nuclear weapons. They call themselves nuclear weapon states. They say they would come to the talks only when they are treated as a nuclear weapon state. So does that mean that they have made up their mind from the beginning to develop nuclear weapons and become a nuclear weapon state? Or they might have changed their mind in the course. They wanted to use it as a bargaining chip, but in the course, because they've been doing quite well with weaponization, they might have thought, well, you know, we should become a nuclear weapon state. Nobody would know which was the case, you know. Probably until when we have unification, probably until when we have all the secrets from North Korean regime come out, nobody might know the truth. But one thing clear about it is that not too many people these days think North Korea is using its nuclear weapons as a bargaining chip. But still, we cannot leave North Korea becoming a nuclear weapon state. So what do we do? There have been moments of truth, 1992, 2000 to 2008, but all at these moments of truth, North Koreans chose not to give up their nuclear weapons. I think we should still make efforts to make it more difficult for DPRK to develop weapons of mass destruction, which will force it to reconsider its policy. Then how can we make it more difficult? I think one thing we are doing is Security Council sanctions. Some people say, well, are sanctions really working, you know? With sanctions, North Korea seem to be okay. You know, they are still going for provocations. They are still developing weapons. So what are the sanctions for? The way I see it, sanctions work, but it worked only in an accumulated form. So you continue sanctions year after year, and eventually it takes toll. We have seen the cases with many other countries, Iran, Libya. You know, sanctions looked like not working in the beginning, but eventually, years after years of implementation, they worked because they hurt. They hurt people's life. If you have sanctions, you cannot have proper trade. You cannot have proper financial activities with the foreign countries. No country in the world is an island. No country can survive by itself. So I think eventually it works, but it takes time. So those who want to see effect immediately, you know, sanctions don't look like working. So in South Korea, we are going for what we call two-track approach. You know, we go for sanctions, but at the same time, we open our door for dialogue. And I think last week, the President Park Geun-hye has visited here. They had a joint summit statement in which the two leaders also said to bring North Korea back to credible and meaningful talks as soon as possible. They will make their efforts. So the case of Iran is, there is similarity and differences, of course, but I think the Iranian case is also one of the proofs that sanctions work can be effective. And diplomatic negotiations can bring results. The second issue, human rights issue, what is going to happen? I think the basic approach in the UN when it comes to human rights issue is called naming and shaming. The UN's human rights discussion doesn't have teeth. It's not like Security Council sanctions. But still, when you discuss a certain country's human rights in the UN and adopt resolutions every year, it makes difference. There are only about less than 10 countries in the world whose human rights cases are on the agenda of United Nations. No countries want that. You know, no countries want their human rights case on the agenda of UN, and they have voting on it every year. So voting shows in concrete figure what other countries in the world think about their human rights. No country likes that. So that's what is called naming and shaming approach. And I think it also works eventually. In the case of North Korea, even though we have been doing that for the last 10 years, in the beginning, they didn't care. They didn't care until 2013. You know, North Korea didn't show any interest in whatever human rights resolutions the United Nations adopted. But last year, North Korea responded sensitively. They argued that they don't have human rights violations in North Korea. They said that they are willing to invite UN's human rights chiefs from Geneva and from New York also. And they haven't invited them yet, but the fact that they responded sensitively, they tried to stop the adoption of a resolution, which they failed, but the fact that they are responding sensitively is important. And that's what the United Nations aims to see when they have this naming and shaming approach. Inter-Korean reconciliation and cooperation. You know, we in Korea, the reunion, a new round of reunion of separate families just started, which we think is a good sign. But still, North Koreans are threatening another launch of long-range missiles, which qualifies for Security Council, new Security Council resolution. So we hope they will not do that. We hope there won't be any need for new Security Council action. So we hope they stay on the path for dialogue and exchanges, like the reunion of separate families. But if they misjudge again, they get out of it, and they go back to the provocation, go back to provocations, then I think we will, that will have to met with a clear message from the international community. There has been cases of inter-Korean cooperation, like Kaesong Industrial Park, family reunions, Mount Geumgang project, which has been suspended. When the right moment arrives, there will be opportunities for UN to play a greater role, including the Secretary General's mediation role. You know, Secretary General, Mr. Ban Ki-moon, was about to visit North Korea last May. I was there too. I was going to accompany him to Kaesong, if that had come true, but they stopped it just on the eve of the visit. Former UN Secretary Generals also made efforts in the Korean issues, and actually the last UN Secretary General who went to North Korea was Boutros-Ghali about 20 years ago. Before him, Kurt Waldheim went to North Korea twice. So we, the current governments in South Korea, we think we should make efforts for reunification, because a unified Korea will be the fundamental solution to the North Korean nuclear and human rights issues, and will close the final chapter on the history of the Cold War. So that everyone in South Korea wants reunification. And put together, if we become a member of the United Nations as a unified Korea, we will be 19th in population, 13th in GDP, and 13th in UN financial contributions. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador. The floor is open. David?
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador. Those were quite comprehensive remarks, and I especially thank you for the history of the United Nations and its relation to the Korean Peninsula. I think we should remember even the armistice, paragraph 60, made reference to the solving the Korea question, and you know, calling on all the parties to come together within 90 days to solve the Korea question, which we failed that suspense there. And I agree with you 100% that we are not going to see the end of the nuclear program and the human rights violations and crimes against humanity until there's unification. But given the press that's here, I understand if you can't answer this question, but I really like to hear your thoughts on what role you think the United Nations writ large, and perhaps even the United Nations command that is still in Korea, will play in terms of unification, particularly if unification happens after resumption of hostilities by North Korea and they're defeated, or if the regime, the Kim family regime, collapses. What role do you think the United Nations will have in supporting Korean unification?
It's not easy for the United Nations to play a role in the unification process, not least because North Korea still regards the UN as a former enemy. After all, the armistice was signed
by the UN,
by North Korea, China,
and the UN,
and the U.S. force commander in his capacity as UN commander. So there has never been a North Korean head of state participating in any UN meeting. This year and last year, the North Korean foreign minister came to UN General Assembly, which represents quite an upgrade in their representation. So usually their vice minister comes to the UN. So that shows North Korea's basic attitude towards the United Nations. So that's why I say it's not easy for the UN to play a role in the unification process. But I can see a few areas where the UN can still play a role. For example, Secretary General Ban Ki-moon is a South Korean national, even though he's now international civil servant. And he still has 1 year and 2 months before the end of his term. So I think if things turn right, you know, for him, he can still play a role of mediation. You know. Another way is, of course, I already told you about the Security Council's sanctions and the annual human rights resolutions. Even though the latter is not coercive, it's more naming and shaming approach. But these days, we think both of them work to a certain extent. When I say it works, that means it hurts North Korea. Not only North Korean regime, but North Korea as a whole. When it hurts North Korea, I think they should do about should do something about it. And then probably they would want to reduce the effect of sanctions, if not terminate them. Probably they want to avoid North Korean human rights issue on the agenda of the United Nations. If they feel that way, that means that they have to do something about it. And the whole purpose of these things might be to make them feel they have to do something about it. So I think in that sense, it could work, and it hopefully it could work for the benefit of unification, not the other way around, not for confrontation. So that's how the UN can also play a role. And you mentioned UN command. Of course, UN command is the U.S. troops in South Korea also serving as a UN command, and that is more symbolic these days. But I think that still has quite importance, and from time to time, you know, North Koreans argue that that should change. You know, the UN command in Korea should change, and armistice should be replaced by a peace agreement. And the fact that they argue these things mean that the presence of UN command in South Korea makes difference. You know, it's not nothing to them. It's something to them. So that's three ways I can think of right now.
Yeah. Thank you, Ambassador. Thank Peter.
You. Mr. Ambassador, thank you so much. I'm Peter Husey, and I had the privilege of living in the Republic of Korea for 2 years, in 1969 and 70 as a hoksang at Yangtze Hakyo. And my Korean father was Hempyeon Chun, who, as you know, became ambassador to the United States and the United Nations. My question is this on the North Korean nuclear program. I believe its purposes are multiple. Given that, do you see any prospects that the North Koreans can be induced to give up their nuclear weapons?
That's very hard to tell. I think that should be a very tough question to anyone, you know. During my presentation, I earlier said that in the beginning, opinion was divided as to whether North Koreans want to use nuclear weapons as a bargaining chip or they really want to have nuclear weapons. When they want to use it as a bargaining chip, it's easier for us to remove them because we can also play the game and use their bargaining chip. But if it's not bargaining chip, you know, they are really intent on having nuclear weapons, it's a more difficult story, you know. How do you enforce a country that is determined to have nuclear weapons not to have them? But we all want do that peacefully, through dialogue, through negotiations. So eventually, North Korea could come back to six-party talks, but not as a nuclear weapon state. North Korea cannot come back to six-party talks as a nuclear weapon state, you know. They should come back to the talks only when they are ready to negotiate giving up their nuclear weapons. In the meantime, I think the sanctions, because I believe they work, we should make sure that sanctions are implemented faithfully.
Thank you. Tom, would you please hold your questions for the next round? But Bruce is already here. We are running late. Okay, hold it. Well, let's give Ambassador Oh a big round of applause.
Yeah, come.
Bruce, We are absolutely delighted that we have in-house speaker. Had a good lunch?
Yes, we did.
Okay, it's all yours. Thank you, Bruce.
All right, well, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be a guest here at 214 Massachusetts Avenue since I work here, but it's a pleasure to be a part of the ICAS symposium. I'm going to focus on President Pak's visit last week and sort of give assessment of it. And I'll try to be brief to allow my gauntlet of commentators here a chance, as well as people in the audience. I think overall I would classify the summit as important, successful, but not very exciting. Important for any number of reasons. The most obvious is that when two allies face a very real and very growing threat, it's always important to have the senior leadership, including at the presidential level, to coordinate policy, to ensure that our deterrent and defense capabilities are fine. Also, it was a way of sending messages, very important messages, that there's no daylight between the two allies, the two partners, the two friends. Also to counter some of the perceptions of supposed U.S. concerns that South Korea was slipping the moorings and going full steam ahead towards China, leaving the alliance in its wake. Those concerns, I think, were stronger in Korea than they were in Washington, but it was important to try to counter some of that. And successful because I think they accomplished those missions, they affirmed the relationship behind the scenes, they were discussing military issues that are critical. And when I said unexciting, it's because there were no new deliverables. That's sort of diplomatic parlance for a new agreement, a new sort of a breakthrough in longstanding negotiations. But in that sense, really, the partnership is a victim of its own success, in that the U.S. and Korea, we've already achieved a free trade agreement. We already did an alliance guidelines revision 2 years ago. You know, we even finished the civilian nuclear agreement earlier this year. So really, we've already done so many things, and there are really very few, if any, irritants between the two countries. So it was unexciting because we've already accomplished the big things, and it was also unexciting because it lacked the drama of the U.S.-China summit, because, of course, we're competitors, we have a great number of concerns about Chinese behavior, and we don't have those concerns with South Korea. So overall, I think it was very successful. It was also important for President Pak to come because it sort of completes the trifecta of U.S. Summits with Northeast Asian nations. We've already had Prime Minister Abe, we had Chinese President Xi Jinping. So had President Pak not come, that might have been perceived as a signal, even if it was not intended as so. I think the timing of the meeting was also good in that it was better to have it happen now than back in June when she was originally scheduled to come. Had she come in June, there would have been much more direct comparison of President Pak's trip with Prime Minister Abe's trip. When she was coming at that time, many of us were counseling the media and others to sort of not compare specific things from the April visit of Abe with the June visit of Pak, because President Pak already had her address to Congress. She already had her big state dinner, so don't make a direct comparison, because she would not get those same level of diplomatic niceties because she had already achieved them. So I think by having it not so closely aligned, then we didn't have that direct comparison. And also, there would have been some progress on the history issue. Had she come in June, it would have been much more in the forefront. The August 15 statement by Prime Minister Abe, any of us would have written it differently. There were things in there that we didn't like. There were things that we would have preferred he added. But overall, the consensus view in Washington was that it was good, pretty good, admittedly perhaps grading on a curve. And then President Pak's response was also seen as good to pretty good, so that it helped reduce some of the focus, the pressure on historic issues. And actually, since Prime Minister Abe's trip, we've seen, I think, a real heartfelt approach by both countries to try to, kind of lower the heat on this issue. We've had exchange or meetings of the defense ministers, the foreign ministers, the finance ministers, et cetera. So I think we're trying to make progress on that issue. Now, the agenda.
North Korea was once again at the top of the agenda, as you would expect, particularly after the August landmine and artillery exchange crisis, and then North Korea's threats once again to violate UN Security Council resolutions by launching a long-range missile. Now, the October 10th date, I think, was always a bit of a misperception, largely by the media. There was a misperception or a misunderstanding of the construction activity, which is observed on unclassified satellite imagery at the launch facility. The media seemed to go hyper over the creation of an environmental cover or concealment device. And then there were the vague North Korean statements, not vague in the sense of we will launch a missile, but very vague on the timing of it. And I think what we saw was an iteration by the media of, well, you know, they might do it during this anniversary. And then it was, they could do it, and then they probably will, to they have vowed to do it on October 10th, all of which was incorrect. So what we've seen is sort of a reverse mischaracterization, that when North Korea didn't launch on the date that the pundits or the media predicted, now there's the assessment of why didn't they do what we predicted they would do? And you've already seen articles of attributing the non-event to Chinese pressure or a problems with the missile system or the desire by Kim Jong-un to improve inter-Korean relations, or even some where Kim Jong-un has matured, he's pushed back the hardliners, and now he's finally able to engage in diplomacy, which is he's always had as his innermost desire. All of those are really off the mark. I think the joint statement on North Korea was very important, the first of its kind, because it clearly articulated South Korean and U.S. policy. And people behind the scenes will say, there is no daylight. They are the same thoughts. They are the same words. Now, that wasn't always the case in the U.S.-South Korean relationship, but right now we really are on the same sheet of music, largely because of North Korea's repeated violations and belligerent behavior. But some of the messages that should be taken from the joint statement is that neither the U.S. nor South Korea will be lowering the bar on the conditionality. There had been perceptions on one hand that the U.S., because we've changed our policy to Cuba, Myanmar, or Burma, and Iran, that we would have a similar desire to outreach to North Korea. No. As administration officials will emphasize, as well as other experts, there really is a great deal of difference between Iran, Burma, Cuba, and North Korea. Whatever you think of the Iran deal, whatever you think about the change in policy towards Burma and Cuba, you at least had countries that were willing to change somewhat. North Korea has clearly made very emphatically clear that through its actions and its rhetoric, it will not give up its nuclear weapons, it will not abandon its continued violations of U.S. law, international law, and U.N. resolutions. And also on the Korean side, there's sort of that repeated, well, every Korean president wants a legacy, and a legacy means a summit with North Korea, and therefore President Park would lower the bar and be so eager for a legacy that she'll, you know, be willing to do anything to have a summit. And that also has been made, you know, that she will remain more principled than that. Some of the other issues that perhaps not front and center on the official documents, but I think in people's minds, were China. You know, just to make clear that President Park did not need to explain to the U.S. government why she went to Beijing. It was a difficult decision. Clearly, it was controversial. The U.S. has great trust and respect in President Park, so we're not nervous that she's you know, abandoning the alliance and moving too far towards China. You know, that said, there are some reasons for questions or a bit of concerns. I mean, when not only the attendance in Beijing, but, you know, when I've had National Assembly members tell me things like, you know, because of the history issue, South Korea feels more comfortable with China right now than the U.S., or China or South Korea may need to choose China over the United States in the future. Now, those were remarks made more when the history issue was bubbling hotter. But, you know, there are some thoughts. And I think, the consensus view amongst experts in Washington was it was perfectly fine. Indeed, it was good for President Park to go to Beijing to meet with Xi Jinping to discuss a number of issues, particularly North Korea, to try to get Chinese willingness to fully abide by required UN Security Council resolution sanctions. But we thought it was a mistake to attend the parade. Korean officials will say, well, the way the Chinese created the protocol, there was absolutely no way we couldn't attend the parade. Of course there is. You're a sovereign president, you can get on a plane, you can leave. So we thought it was unfortunate to attend the parade. We knew it was going to be over-the-top anti-Japanese rhetoric as a way of diverting attention away from China's belligerent actions, Chinese expansionist policies. And also there was sort of that odd optic of the South Korean president reviewing the troops of the last country to invade South Korea, one which is responsible for the deaths of so many South Koreans without any apologies for that, whose involvement in the Korean War extended the war, thus increasing South Korean casualties and devastation, and also being responsible, as China is responsible for the continued division of the Korean Peninsula. So it was a bit of an odd optic there. But I think the discussions by the presidents and certainly President Obama's statement was that, we are fully trusting and of President Park, and it's good for South Korea to have a strong relationship with Beijing in order to try to gain progress on North Korea. Another country which wasn't mentioned much, but perhaps was a bit of a shadow there, was Japan. In her public speech at CSIS, President Park twice in her prepared remarks emphasized the importance of U.S., South Korean, Japanese, coordination on policy towards North Korea. I thought that was very, very positive, very encouraging, because she didn't mention any kind of conditionality. Now, in the subsequent question from a member of the audience, when asked, could you have a bilateral meeting with Prime Minister Abe, we got back to some of the conditionality that we've seen under President Park. Now, whether by accident or design, her comment was was artfully vague, where it's a little unclear, and I went back and looked at it a couple times. When talking about a bilateral with Prime Minister Abe, did she mean a bilateral on the sidelines of the upcoming trilateral summit of South Korea, Japan, China, or did she mean a separate subsequent bilateral meeting with Prime Minister Abe? Also, I thought it a little unclear that when she talked about such a meeting would be significant or important if there was progress on the comfort women issue. To me, at least, it was unclear whether that was still a precondition that she would not agree to a summit unless there was prior progress at lower levels on comfort women and other history issues, or whether it was if there was a sense or an assurance that there would be progress in the summit meeting with Prime Minister Abe that she would then agree. Anyway, it's sort of a metric of different possibilities there, but I think overall the context is that there has been improving relations, perhaps the last 6 months, between South Korea and Japan, and just this week we're seeing the South Korean defense minister meeting with his Korean counterpart. If I were to point to some shortcomings or things that I would have liked to see, it was really more details or actions of some of the very positive words. So we had positive statement about we will respond firmly if North Korea does another violation, but we didn't see specifics. Now, okay, you want to keep your cards close to your chest. You don't want to telegraph what exactly you're going to do. But there are other things both countries could have done, either during the summit or separately. President Obama has said North Korea is the most heavily sanctioned country in the world. He's wrong. He is flat out wrong. The U.S., UN, EU imposed far stronger sanctions on Iran and targeted financial measures than on North Korea. That's one of the reasons they came back to the table. The U.S. unilaterally has done things to Iran, Burma, Syria, Belarus, Zimbabwe that we haven't done to North Korea. We have twice as many Zimbabwe entities on the U.S. sanctions list as North Korean entities. So there are a number of things we can do. And I think also Korea could have either announced some new actions or identified that what some of the specifics that they might do during a response to another provocation. Also, I would have liked to see, when talking about improving or maintaining the deterrence and defense of the peninsula, talking about THAAD, that's the ballistic missile defense system, which neither country is really talking about because South Korea is so skittish about it, given Chinese pressure and economic blackmail. The three no's policy of Korea right now is that there's been no decision made on the U.S. deployment of THAAD to the peninsula, there has been no U.S. request, and indeed there have been no discussions, official, unofficial, or any kind between U.S. and South Korean officials, almost, it seems, to the point of denying that the word THAAD has been mentioned in anyone's presence. So I think, you know, the proper response would be, of course we're talking about THAAD, we're allies. We talk about what kind of bullets to use, what kind of aircraft, what kind of submarines, where to deploy forces, how many forces, you know, the South Korean ongoing defense reform, et cetera. You know, of course we're talking about THAAD. When it's better than any system that South Korea has or will have for decades, it would improve, you know, the protection of the South Korean people and the U.S. forces there to defend Korea. So I was disappointed, but I didn't expect a commentary on THAAD, but I think it would have been a good time for an announcement. And finally, and I'll bring it to a close here, North Korean human rights. There was a statement about it, but again, no actionable items. You know, again, whether it was during the summit or, you know, up until now, I would have liked to see President Park say, I will go back and I will fight for implementation of a North Korean Human Rights Act, that 10 years of debate in the National Assembly is long enough. We need to take action on this, you know, these heinous, you know, actions by North Korea, which, as Ambassador Oh said, are crimes against humanity. And also the U.S. could also have identified actions that we've taken, which to date is nothing. Despite a year and a half after the Commission of Inquiry report, the U.S. right now has zero North Korean entities on the sanctions list for human rights violations. Now, the State Department has vowed we are thinking about this, we are discussing this, we are considering action. It's been a year and a half. And when the Commission report came out, it wasn't exactly a surprise. So the U.S. has, I think, been dragging its feet on action. The U.S. Sanctioned by name the presidents of Belarus and Zimbabwe. We haven't identified a single North Korean entity, person, or organization to sanction. So I think there are actionable things or specifics that I would have liked to see, but I wasn't really expecting that. But overall, as I said in the beginning, I think the summit meeting was very important and very successful. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Louis.
Now, Tom, with this, can you go up to the far left? Okay.
Oh, next to Dave? Yeah. Okay.
Okay, Tom, please. Yeah. Okay. Discuss, number one, we talk so much about sanctions, and as Ambassador Oh said, sanctions work cumulatively, as it worked on Iran when they finally were able to reach a Iran nuclear deal. But big difference between Iran and North Korea. Sanctions have not worked on North Korea as effectively or as much as it was wished by the United Nations Security Council, for example. Iran had some, like they're getting immediately something around $100 to $150 billion as a result of the lifting of the sanctions. North Korean's assets, frozen assets, are very minimal, not much. And there is no guarantee what North Korea can get. And another big difference is North Korea has already developed a nuclear weapon, and Iran said it was not developing nuclear weapon, but we suspect that Iran surely was developing nuclear weapons. That's the gist of all the Iranian deal was about. Now, on unification, I think it's something conference on Korean Peninsula issue touches upon. And Ambassador Oh went through all the landmarks occasions that were dealt in the UN Security Council as far as the Korean issue was concerned. But I don't know what I heard. Before the Korean War broke out, there was UN temporary commission on Korea overseeing free elections in the South because North Korea denied access by the UN temporary commission on Korea to come to North Korean part. So, but in that resolution, it said United Nations were hoping and pursuing a peacefully unified democratic Korea. And ever since then, the unification subject has never been dealt on the level of the United Nations or its Security Council. Although between US and South Korea, since 2009, when they issued a joint statement on the future vision of the alliance, that was the first time U.S. officially endorsed the South Korean policy of unification by means of peaceful and democratic elections. And that statement still stands, and I think even last week's joint statement also included one provision on that. That is, United States is supporting Korea's peaceful approach to unification. Now, coming back to Bruce's part of a discussion, I would say, I mean, I agree with a very accurate description of what happened, although there were a lot of questions. But my first reaction to the result of the summit was this, very simple. Bruce said, well, there was no lowering down or lowering the bar, or there is no concession on the conditionality. True. But that creates a problem as far as I can see it, because because the U.S. and South Korea agreed to stay the current course of North Korea policy. That is, if North Korea shows credible evidence that it has made a decision to give up its nuclear weapons, then we are open to engage them. We certainly talk to them, and then we go from there. Interestingly enough, Danny Russell, Assistant Secretary of State for East Pacific and East Asian Pacific Affairs, described the negotiation. When they come to negotiation does not really mean a surrender or giving up everything. It's engagement with serious positions, and we go from there. So I thought I heard this one pre-briefing by NSC and Ambassador Lippert and Danny Russell. They were all previewing what the President Park's visit is going to be like. Now, again, there is no new approach. What troubles me most is we talked about collapsibility of North Korea or North Korean regime or possibility of unifying or advancing to the North and defeat the North Korean enemy. We can hope for that if North Korea invades the South, then the combined operational plan is not only to, if we fail to deter, then we would certainly defeat North Korean aggression, and then destroy the North Korean regime, that will create a new opportunity for unification by means of force. But that conditionality to that is if North Korea attacks and invades in full and wages a full all-out war. And to me, it's highly unlikely. Unless Kim Jong-un thinks, well, my days are numbered, there is no other way or no means left to survive his system, I think they will hang on there. As Ambassador O pointed out, that he's not going to give up his nuclear weapons. But nevertheless, even in this hour, North Koreans are still developing, and continue to develop their nuclear technology and missiles and nuclear tests. Even Bruce wrote one piece when everybody was saying that, now that North Koreans didn't do anything on the 70th anniversary of the founding of their Workers' Party, they did not, they threatened, a lot of people thought they might do it, and but there was no any official or secret channel either from Beijing or Washington telling the North Koreans, please don't do this. If you want to do this, then it's going to be a real creative problem. We will have to take you to United Nations Security Council and to impose more severe sanctions and stricter implementation of the current sanctions already in place. No message as such has been related to Pyongyang leadership other than through public forums of South Korea and even White House and some of the people in this town have said they should not do that, you know, anyway. But Bruce even said, well, they have not done it this time, but they will do it in the future. I don't know when they're going to do it. I would not be surprised. I'm not I was a bit surprised myself why they really stopped, didn't do what they threatened to do by so many implications and different statements of lower levels. But here is what it counts. Unless you hear from the directly from the horse's mouth, the horse representing North Korea is Kim Jong-un, the leader. He hasn't said anything. So we're going to have to wait for what he really might have to say. Okay, I'm not going to take too much. Human rights issues. I was going to ask Ambassador, there was a lot of a talk and the General Assembly even passed a resolution to take the findings of the Committee of Inquiry on the situation of North Korean human rights to ICC. And that was it. The trouble is, United States is supporting this kind of a movement, supporting human rights, improvement of human rights in North Korea. It's not even a member of the ICC treaty. Again, Senate, U.S. Congress has not ratified U.S. affiliation with the ICC system. Now, so if United States is in that system, you're going to have a stronger position of strength to push this story. But the thing is, there are so many findings, and the Congress created a job for North Korea human rights ambassador, envoy here. But my point is, despite all these legislative support and activities carried out by the UN Committee of Human Rights and what have you, and all the declarations elsewhere in the world, none of that actually contributed to the actual improvement of human rights in North Korea. And that is a fact. And I remember even Jimmy Carter one time said the United States should not be in a position to press upon North Korea in terms of human rights, because looking at what's happening here at home in the United States. That's Bill Clinton who said that. Now, I'm going to say just one more thing. That is, so you, Bruce, you still think North Korea may not or will launch nuclear test or missile anytime soon?
I think they're going to launch. I think it was just not on October 10th. I think people. Yeah.
But
I
mean, you speculated the three different possibilities of whether it was a Chinese pressure, but there was no pressure from China. No pressure from China, no pressure from Washington, and whether Kim Jong-un has matured and he restrained himself on going on those launches his lower people talk so much about. And another thing is you talked about the possible deployment of THAAD. I think it is good we have to watch North Korea. We have to increase our military deterrent, enhance the deterrent to stop. The problem was the deterrent has been very successful in entire history of the U.S.-Iraq alliance to deter a major war. But it has not succeeded in deterring provocations like the West Sea instance, and also recently DMZ incident. These things keep appalling. But the thing is, unless you engage in North Korea, unless we find some peaceful resolution to this issue, of military hostility between North and South. Unless we mobilize some diplomatic and dialogue with North Koreans, somehow reduce tension and to prevent war in Korea. But I am for the idea of investing in deterrent because there is no alternative as things stand today. But my concern is this continuing arms race will go on. And who benefits from it? It's not the South Korean people. It is necessary. It's too bad we have to do this. But it's so costly. And South Korea and the United States, we talk so, such airtight or no daylight between U.S. and South Korea in terms of alliance, how strong they are. But just the last week, and the United States, by its own law, it cannot transfer technology, some sensitive defense and security technology, to even as a close ally as South Korea. They refused to turn over or give this technology so that it resulted in a firing of Blue House as a chief secretary for foreign affairs, Chul-Gi, and he was fired. And the Minister Han Ming-bu talked to Ash Carter at the Pentagon and asked for this thing, and he was rejected. His request was rejected because these are some of the things even allies don't share. And traditionally, the United States did not want to provide any offensive weapons to even its own allies, always defensive types of weapons, because while the United States is committed to the defense of South Korea, they don't want South Korea to go to North Korea militarily either. So that was a deterrent on both sides. That was the whole idea of the strategic alliance that was sealed by the treaty, Mutual Defense Treaty, 1954, was it? So my point is, peace is better. Dialogue is better than confrontation. Peace is better than war. To find and contribute to peace, you gotta have some military deterrent and capability, but at the same time, you gotta seek and make a special effort to come up with some kind of new ideas, creative approaches to North Korea or anywhere else for that matter.
Thank you very much, Tom. Joe?
Yeah, I know the audience needs to participate. Just one very quick one for Bruce, who gave an excellent update of the presentation at the summit. Bruce, what do you think of this explanation for the dog that didn't bark, that is, that North Korea did not fire a missile or explode a nuclear weapon, that Madam Park made clear to Xi Jinping that she would not attend the Beijing parade if that happened, and China then put leverage on North Korea and said, we won't attend your celebration if you do something that provocative.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Bruce, you have comments?
Are we going through others, or do you want me to?
Okay, why don't you respond to Joe's comments?
Yeah, it's an unknowable, but I think that gives more credit to Chinese influence than is the case. China has said, when we've ever criticized them about not doing enough on North Korea, they've said, we can't really do much. They've tried to get North Korea not to launch the missiles, to not do nuke tests, and yet they've done it in the past. So, and I think the timing of it is because President Park didn't make the decision until very close to the event, we would have seen more indications of launch preparations even by then. So I think it's North Korea will launch. They wouldn't have devoted so much resources and prioritized so much scarce resources in order to build the Sohae launch facility and to continue to upgrade it to an even larger missile if they didn't intend to use it. They'll launch, and then they will use the justification of the UN response as justification for doing a nuclear test. And we'll go through the cycle again, but I think it's giving China too much credit. I think on some of the other points that Tung brought up is, you know, on sanctions, you know, it's very easy to say sanctions don't work, but diplomacy didn't work either. We had, even under the unconditional benefits provided, you know, during the progressive administrations, we had provocations, we had deadly clashes in the West Sea, we had continued violations of the agreed framework, we had proliferation to Syria, et cetera. And also, you know, mm-hmm. sanctions, there's a difference between sanctions and targeted financial measures. I won't go into a lot of it. You know, but there are things that we can do to North Korea that's going after their finances. Because they use, you know, dollar-denominated transaction, it means for the vast majority of all their transactions, that means they go through a U.S. Treasury Department-regulated bank in the United States. That gives us tremendous leverage. Also, there are five purposes to sanctions and targeted financial measures: to enforce the law, to impose a pain or a penalty when people do break the law, to try to eliminate or at least constrain the inflow of prohibited items, including illicit money, into North Korea for their prohibited nuclear and missile programs, to eliminate or constrain proliferation, and then five, the most difficult, using all the instruments of national power to try to alter their behavior. I'd say on the four of the five, they've been effective, and on the fifth, it's just as effective when we use it in diplomacy as when we tried using diplomacy alone. The difference between North Korea and Iran is we did apply stronger pressure on Iran. So we have applied fewer sanctions. We've applied them more weakly on North Korea. And we have not done secondary violations against China and others that are violating the resolutions. You know, and it's nice to say we want to engage North Korea, but when they refuse to engage, it's pretty tough to talk to someone if they won't pick up the phone. North Korea has said they've changed their constitution. Kim Jong-un has said, every senior organization in North Korea has said, we will never, ever, ever, ever give up our nuclear weapons. The six-party talks are dead. We will never go back to the six-party talks. If they were to say, we'll give you a one in a trillion chance we'll give up our nuclear weapons, that's more than they're giving us now. So, you know, I think we've tried diplomacy. We should always remain open to the potential for conditional diplomacy. But it's really hard when they won't pick up the phone.
Thank you, Bruce. One of our interns? Yes. Would you please identify yourself? And thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to thank the panel for the discussion today. My name is Mike Bassett, and I work on facilitating people-to-people exchange projects in North Korea. I've been doing this for the past 3 years. And I have a question for you all, which is kind of rooted in the base of my logic to engage the country in the first place. And we say they don't pick up the phone, but I can email or call any North Korean that I want today, and they'll respond to me within about an hour. So my question is, if we are to recognize that North Korea's nuclear program increased under sanctions and agree that resolving North Korea nuclear proliferation and human rights issues can be achieved by unification and peace, and that missile launches are a way of flexing muscles, and that DPRK will let their people die before abandoning the program and sacrifice them to develop the program, then how can we justify continuing this sort of course, which will only result in more nukes, more human suffering, and a perpetual state of Cold War status quo, division, and militarism? Or is the NLL and the TPP going to be the justification for maintaining the status quo on the peninsula? Thank you.
Yeah, you did the homework. Okay, anyone want to crack?
I'd say that, yeah. You know, as for nuclear weapons, only one Korea has them. That Korea has promised three times to give up the nuclear weapons that they previously promised four times never to develop. Only one Korea has invaded the other. Only one Korea has attempted to assassinate the president of the other. The list goes on and on. So, you know, if we take a value-neutral policy like China does toward the Koreas, calling on both to show restraint and to lower tensions, only one's been a belligerent, only one's been a provocateur. So, you know, the presence of U.S. forces on the peninsula, the presence of the South Korean military is in response to repeated North Korean acts of war, to terrorism or provocation. So we thought we were able to, we were going to get rid of the nuclear weapons with the agreed framework and the six-party talks. We thought we were going to prevent the nuclear weapons with a number of other agreements. You know, I'd say successive administrations in both countries have tried. You know, there's no monopoly by either political party on good or bad ideas, but I think what we've seen is a lot of different attempts to get North Korea to act in a manner consistent with international law and international norms of behavior, and it's Pyongyang that's repeatedly, you know, broken its word or refused. You know, when we talk about engaging them, you know, President Obama really, you know, I think really tried in 2009, and they very quickly showed they were going to act just as badly to him as to Bush. And then in 2012, we had the Leap Day Agreement. You know, we were trying to get them to, you know, start their way back towards abiding by their commitments, and, you know, they abandoned that policy or that agreement as well. So I think people have tried.
I want to add to that, that is, diplomacy has not been exhausted yet. History does not end. Diplomacy does not end. We pay diplomats their salaries. Their job is to work on diplomacy, diplomatic issues. North Korea still remains as a potential subject issue that can be resolved diplomatically. People say, well, we tried that. We don't be cheated again. Why should we buy the same pulse twice and so forth? But nevertheless, what's alternative? We're just watching them building and developing, increasing their nuclear arsenal, developing more formidable long-range missiles that with which they threaten to not only its own neighbors, they even says threaten to even attack the United States. I think diplomacy has a still role. Remember, before Iranian negotiations started, Obama talked to Iranian president for 10 minutes. And Kim Jong-il said, I'm waiting. A lot of calls they turned out, but any of you think if President Obama calls Kim Jong-un tonight, you think he would decline to receive the call?
He wants to play a game of basketball.
Okay. Now, and then there was a talk of changing envoys again. These security publications and diplomacy could be a separate issue, and sometimes it did not always work out as liberals expected or hoped for. But, for example, the West Sea incident, that took place during the incumbency of former President Kim Dae-jung. And they had a hotline, and the South Koreans called North Koreans right away, and they got the explanation. It was not an order. It was not the intention of their leader, Kim Jong-il. So they put it down. And that was one example of what happened. So what the diplomacy can do. It's not everything is bad, but that does not exonerate North Korea from a record of all vicious and very hostile and unconstructive and dangerous provocations that they have committed. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is somebody gotta be doing something about the North Korean situation, especially the danger that North Korea is keep increasing its formidable weapons of mass destruction.
Thank you, Tong. Peter, quickly, yes?
I'm gonna have to shock my friend here and agree a little bit with him that, yes, diplomacy. I was at the Swiss embassy, and they have an interest section in North Korea and in Iran, and they represent, in part, the United States as well as other countries that don't have diplomatic relations with either country. The North Koreans can pick up the phone and agree to get rid of their nuclear weapons any time they want, and no one in the world will say no. They can stop their human rights abuses at any time they wish. There is nothing standing in the way. When I did an analysis of every North Korean terror attack against South Korea and against the United States and against Japan, starting at the end of the Korean War, I cannot find a single time where anybody but they did the provocation.
And we hardly, I mean, we got the Pueblo taken. Did we respond? When I was in South Korea, the president's wife was shot, murdered in church by a North Korean gunman. Did the South Koreans respond? No. Never have, it's very rare you can find the South Koreans or the Americans or the Japanese respond militarily to these kinds of threats. So the nature of the regime is the problem, not the absence of dialogue. But Tong Kim is right that the dialogue and diplomatic channel has to be there, and it has to be used as much as we possibly can, because they may decide tomorrow to change the nature of the regime. We don't know that. And if there's anything we can do diplomatically, particularly to prevent a misunderstanding, because that's where you could have an attack, a exchange of missiles and nukes, if the North Koreans misunderstand what's going on, as opposed to trying to just, they don't care and they're going to deliberately attack us. So it would be wonderful if the North would change its way of living and of acting, and the government. They're free to do that anytime they want. If you think you're sitting in North Korea and this is the best way to provide prosperity for your people, it's the craziest way I know. You don't have to apply to the World Bank for money by saying, oh, by the way, I'm putting in the mail a nuclear bomb just so you get the message, okay? So this is a very tyrannical regime, and yes, we have to maintain diplomatic relations, but we have to defend ourselves as well. And the U.S. security plan has always been to use the minimum force required to deter North Korea. Okay? Give the president that option of using, if possible, no force. That's what missile defense is about. So we don't have to. What's the point of blowing up thousands of North Koreans in case we get attacked? It's to take out the weapons, but if you can't find them and they're launched at you, God, hopefully you can shoot them down, which is what THAAD is all about. It's a defensive weapon. It has no capability against Chinese strategic nuclear capabilities against the United States. That's how I would answer your question.
Thank you, Peter. With that That's understanding, to hold your question, Peter, we have the last speaker, distinguished speaker, is waiting for us. Let's give Bruce a big round of applause.
Thank you, Bruce.
Hi, Glenn. Had a good lunch? Come on.
Okay, thank you.
Glenn Schumer is coming from the Center for American Progress, another outfit in town, and one of the most distinguished commentators. Glenn, it's all yours.
Well, thank you very much for inviting me to address the ICAS Fall Symposium. Before I begin my prepared remarks, I'd just like to say a little bit about myself, since this is probably the first time I've spoken at an ICS event. My focus is primarily on U.S. policies towards Asia, in particular Japan and China. And so I haven't really focused directly on Korea in my recent work, but I was invited very kindly to address this issue of the Korea, Japan, and the United States. Political leadership is the key. So I'd like to spend 20 or 30 minutes just sharing my views with you. From 85 to 1990, I worked at USTR, Office of the U.S. Trade Representative, and had responsibility for trade negotiations with Japan and with China. But in 1990, I joined AT&T, moved to Asia, and worked for 22 years in Asia, focused primarily in Japan, but having regional responsibilities for Japan, Korea, China, and in some of my responsibilities with Southeast Asia. So it's based on that experience and also my current work at the Center for American Progress on focusing on U.S. policies towards Asia that I'd like to address this issue. South Korean President Park addressed a public audience in Washington, D.C. on October 15, 2015. In advance of her speech, the organization solicited the organizers of the speech solicited questions from those who had registered for the event. My submission was as follows. As a close friend and ally of both the United States and Japan, South Korea plays a vital role in promoting the peace and stability of East Asia. However, the ongoing tensions between South Korea and Japan impede the ability of these three countries to work together as effectively as has been the case in the past. What specific measures should South Korea and Japan take to promote closer cooperation? When can we expect the first formal bilateral summit meeting between you and Prime Minister Abe? What role, if any, should the United States play to encourage closer ties between South Korea and Japan? In response to these questions, President Park said she was open to a bilateral meeting with Prime Minister Abe in early November when the leaders of Korea, Japan, and China would gather in Seoul. The quote, "The trilateral meeting allows us to hold in-depth talks, not only with China, but also with Japan. I do feel I can have a bilateral meeting with him. But in order for such a meeting to be really significant, I think it's important that the two countries be able to move toward a more future-oriented change in our relationship, a meeting that does lead to progress on this, that is, comfort women issue can be characterized as a meaningful meeting," close quote. She emphasized that only 47 comfort women survive and that time is running out to reach a resolution while they are still alive. Quote, "Literally, we really don't have much time to make sure that we can bring closure to their pent-up agony. Once we are able to make progress on the issue, I think it is fair to say that the meeting will lead to progress on other issues and can be characterized as a meaningful meeting," close quote. So this response to my questions has led to a variety of interpretations. Much of the mass media speculation has centered on President Park's statement that she was willing to have a one-on-one meeting with Prime Minister Abe, a meeting that has not materialized despite the fact that Mr. Abe has been in office for nearly 3 years since December of 2012. Her statement was seen by optimists that bilateral relations were improving to the point where perhaps a breakthrough summit meeting was possible. On the other hand, skeptics pointed out that the president's response included a clear prerequisite to the summit meeting, i.e., quote unquote, progress on the issue of comfort women. The content of this progress is not clear, although one can infer from past statements by South Korean officials that this would include, first, a formal and sincere apology by the government of Japan, and second, compensation to the victims in the form of monetary payments, not from private sources, as in the case of the Asian Women's Fund, but from the government of Japan. Now, I will not discuss here the details of the history and background of how the issue of comfort women has emerged as the major barrier to a summit meeting between President Park and Prime Minister Abe, and also more largely to improve cooperation between South Korea and Japan. Numerous books and articles have been written and published on this topic, and I'm sure that today's audience is well aware of them. The main point of my presentation today is that political leadership in Japan, South Korea, and the United States is urgently needed to bring about the resolution of this problem. Without such leadership, we risk seeing the trilateral relationship weaken. Although the U.S. and South Korea and the United States and Japan continue to strengthen their relationships, as evidenced by the successful visits to Washington, D.C. by Prime Minister Abe in April, and the successful visit to Washington, D.C. by President Park in October, the relationship between South Korea and Japan is cooler now than at any point in recent memory. This is borne out by the disturbing public opinion poll results showing how the Japanese and South Korean public's favorable views of each other have plunged, and their unfavorable views of each other have soared in recent years. This is reflected by the books and articles critical of South Korea that have increased in Japanese bookstores. Although I don't read Korean, my South Korean friends tell me that they've observed a similar phenomenon of books and articles critical about Japan increasing their shelf space in South Korean bookstores. Just as Korea fatigue is growing in Japan, some in South Korea in recent years appear to be engaged in an effort to isolate Japan by making the following argument. That is, the United States and South Korea enjoy close ties in military security, based on the bilateral mutual security treaty. The South Korea and the United States enjoy a thriving economic relationship, boosted most recently by the Korea-U.S. Free Trade Agreement, and the strong academic and cultural ties symbolized by the more than 70,000 South Korean students studying in the United States show how the ties on the citizenship level, citizen level, are also growing. In addition, the argument goes, South Korea and the U.S. share a common view of history, which is not the case with Japan. Now, the argument is that this view, that is the common view of history, makes South Korea, not Japan, America's most trusted and reliable partner in Asia. Some in South Korea have even gone further to argue that it is not only South Korea and the United States, but also China that share a common view of history, and that Japan is the clear outlier. Perhaps in response to such efforts, the Japanese Ministry of Foreign Affairs, in March of 2015, revised its official view of South Korea in its website from, quote unquote, a quote, an important neighboring country which shares the basic common values of freedom, democracy, a market economy with Japan, close quote, to simply, quote, the most important neighboring country for Japan, close quote, reflecting the deteriorating relationship. My own view, based on my numerous visits to Japan every year, is that the majority of Japanese have not adopted a revisionist view of history. Their expectation of the Japanese political leadership is that it will revive the Japanese economy, create jobs, raise wages, and deal with the demographic challenges Japan faces of a shrinking population, aging population, and low birth rate. And on the foreign policy side, the majority of Japanese, and I think this is reflected both in discussions I have, but also in public opinion polls, majority of Japanese desire that Japan play a constructive and peaceful role in international society, one in which it is respected and admired for its economy, democracy, technology, arts, culture, and contributions to the world. It is therefore, in my view, unfortunate that a small but vocal group of Japanese is conveying the impression to the outside world that Japan is attempting to make a fundamental change in its relationship with the outside world. In this regard, I think it is noteworthy that after Prime Minister Abe concluded his successful state visit to the United States in April, a letter was issued on May 4th, signed by 187, and this was later increased to more than 300, scholars of Japanese studies, entitled Open Letter in Support of Historians in Japan. Signed by some of the leading Japan scholars in the United States, Europe, and Australia, including John Dower, Ezra Vogel, Akira Ida, Ronald Doerr, and Gavin McCormick, the letter states, quote, this year presents an opportunity for the government of Japan to show leadership by addressing Japan's history of colonial rule and wartime aggression in both words and action, close quote. Although worded diplomatically, it was clearly intended to urge Prime Minister Abe to go beyond the Kono Statement of 1993 and the Murayama Statement of 1995 and to take action that would resolve the issue of comfort women. This letter was in reaction to Prime Minister Abe's speech in the joint session of Congress on April 29th, which focused on the post-war reconciliation between Japan and the United States and the strong bilateral relationship that has developed between the United States and Japan over the past 70 years. The fact that the speech did not address broader issues of history, including the issue of comfort women, led many to see it as a missed opportunity. According to several of the signers of this letter that I just quoted, the letter was written in the hope that Prime Minister Abe would address these issues and attempt to resolve them in the 70-year post-war anniversary Prime Minister's Statement of August. Now, as all of you know, the Prime Minister's Statement of August 14th included something for everyone, but did not address the issue of comfort women sufficiently for those who are concerned with this issue. Thus, President Park's comment at her Washington, D.C. speech on October 15th, in which she emphasized the importance of resolving the issue quickly while the 47 survivors are alive, Yeah, I think this was in response to the fact that this the 70th anniversary statement did not deal adequately with this issue. It appears to me that now is the time for the political leaders of South Korea and Japan to take the leadership to resolve this issue once and for all. So let me share with you a personal anecdote. Several years ago, I won't say when I was a graduate student at Harvard University, an associate professor, or assistant professor of political science at Yale University was being considered for a faculty position at Harvard. A University of Chicago PhD and student of the well-known international relations scholar Morton Kaplan, he had been engaged in a multi-year study of post-war U.S.-Japan relations, focusing especially on the reversion of Okinawa to Japan in the early 1970s and on the textile disputes between the U.S. and Japan in the late 1960s and early 1970s. When he gave his presentation at Harvard, he emphasized the important role that individuals and personalities can play in shaping policy outcomes. Among the examples he gave was the distrust that had developed between President Richard Nixon and Prime Minister Eisaku Sato, whom Nixon thought had betrayed him on a promise that Nixon thought Sato had given him to restrain textile exports to the United States. The assistant professor ended up not getting the job offer from Harvard. One of the reasons cited for this decision by the Harvard Selection Committee was that they thought that the professor had not given enough attention to the structural and macro political environment and had given too much emphasis to the issue of individual personality and individual leadership. By contrast, one of the first things I learned when I joined USTR in 1985, and I was told this by my boss, was just how important the role of individuals and personalities and leadership can play and how important they are and sometimes how decisive they can be in determining policy outcomes, including in trade negotiations. I witnessed this firsthand in negotiations between the United States and Japan and China on a wide range of important issues in the 1990s and the 1980s and since. Based on my experiences in the government and observations since leaving government, I'm firmly convinced that individuals, personalities, and leadership can play a decisive role in policy outcomes. It is, after all, people, not machines, who make and implement policy. In reflecting on the recent history of relations between the United States and Japan and Korea, we can also see the important role that individuals and leadership have played. One clear example is in the late 1990s when President Kim Dae-jung and Prime Minister Keizo Ubuchi strengthened bonds of trust and undertook specific policy measures to promote cultural exchange and understanding between South Korea and Japan. Their leadership provided the basis for what later became an enhanced level of popularity and mutual respect between Japanese and South Koreans in the areas of art, music, and culture. The strained relations between Japan and South Korea are a serious concern for the United States, in part because of the need to implement successfully the rebalance to Asia, which requires the cooperation of both Japan and South Korea, working cooperatively with each other, as well as with the United States. President Obama, in his joint press conference with President Park in Seoul in April 2014, said, "I think any of us who look back on the history of what happened to the comfort women here in South Korea, for example, have to recognize that this was a terrible, egregious violation of human rights. Those women were violated in ways that even in the midst of war was shocking. And they deserve to be heard, they deserve to be respected, and there should be an accurate and clear account of what happened," close quote. He then urged Japan to recognize the past honestly and fairly, but also called on Japan and South Korea to look forward as well as backward and, quote, find ways in which the heartache and the pains of the past can be resolved, because the interests today of South Korea, the interests today of Koreans and Japanese people are clearly converge. And added, "My hope would be that we can honestly resolve some of these past tensions and also keep our eyes on the future and the possibilities of peace and prosperity for all people," close quote. United States, as a close ally and friend of both Japan, South Korea and Japan, has the opportunity, and I believe duty, to promote closer ties between the two countries. This is not only for the benefit of South Korea and Japan, but for the United States and for the future of Asia. I know that U.S. efforts along these lines have been taking place with both South Korea and with Japan, often quietly and behind the scenes. But I believe such efforts should be intensified. Perhaps I think that one example of this was the initiative that the Prime Minister Obama, President Obama took in March of 2014, at the time of the Nuclear Security Summit in The Hague, Netherlands, when at the suggestion of President Obama, President Park and Prime Minister Abe met in a trilateral meeting. I would, in fact, propose that the Obama administration select one or more Americans who are trusted by both South Korea and by Japan to work intensively with the two countries to find a mutually acceptable resolution to the problem of comfort women. And I think the time is ripe to do that right now. In conclusion, I'd like to say the future of South Korea-Japan ties is too important to let this issue continue to fester and to impede cooperation between these two essential allies of the United States. The normalization of relations between South Korea and Japan is a necessary component of a peaceful and prosperous East Asia. Thank you.
Since you are standing there, now yes. The floor is open. Tom?
Yeah. Yeah, thanks. I think the speaker is right in the sense that it's been leaders who caused all these problems. And it's leaders who have not been able to resolve the issue, very fundamental issue, such as history and textbook and territorial dispute, and also comfort women issue in particular. He quoted President Obama when he visited Korea last year, and then that was the strongest condemnation of comfort women put into former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton called sexual slavery. And that was the strongest term U.S. President ever condemned such behavior on the part of old imperial Japan. And then there have been a lot of good moments and records of cooperation and reconciliation, and we're going very well. I'm putting the issue of a textbook aside because the South Korea is embroiled by itself between progressive and conservative with respect to how they're going to treat history, write their textbooks only. So I would not get into the textbook issue, but history. I think Prime Minister Abe, when he was over here, and also not directly mentioned its relationship or what he did to Korea during the Japanese colonial occupation of the Korean Peninsula, but nevertheless, he apologized what Japan did during the, especially to the United States, what it did during the war. And then, as he pointed out, August statement on the 70th anniversary of the end of World War II, Abe came a little bit forward, more conciliatory with respect to this history issues. But as you pointed out, I wasn't really clear with the President Park really meant what kind of it's going to be the summit of the Abe on the sideline of three trilateral talks. It's going to take place. That's going to take place in November, or separate summit as Bruce discussed, or whether she meant and you read that part of the. Of Park's statement that he could meet Japanese Prime Minister, but as long as the meeting, such a meeting, should be future-oriented, and at the same time, there should be some progress, some resolution of the issue of comfort women. What level that issue ought to be, President Park implied to be resolved, we're not sure, but nevertheless, that is still, it remains as a conditionality. What is really bad is for both people of Japan and South Korea is because of these leaders have some bickerings or whatever, these people, I mean, there were a lot of Japanese tourists who used to go, and there was Korean Hanryu, very popular in Japan, but they turned against the mutually hostile in bookstores and publications and some rallies in Tokyo, main street in Tokyo, or some not really demonstration. I used to go on a lot of television talk shows, and all these pundits, South Korean pundits, when we get together to talk about ROK, Republic of Korea and Japan relations, we could just bash Japan, Japanese Abe with impunity. That's what the audience we expected of the speakers to bash Japan, say bad things about Japan, and that was the atmosphere. But so my question is, just recently, Korean prosecution requested that court impose the Sankei Seoul branch chief to serve a year and a half in imprisonment, in prison, for the alleged crime that which he actually did. It's not alleged fact, but the fact is he did report rumors that President Park was meeting with a man for his her personal relationship during the ferry incident was taking place. There was a lot of discussion and questions were about President Park during the first 8 hours, and that's the time Sankei Chief wrote the story. Now, I'm concerned how it's going to be seen in the international community. South Korea is not on the top list as far as the observance of the or respecting the freedom of speech or freedom of the press. You think it would hurt the image of South Korea as guaranteeing the freedom of speech, and how reaction from Japanese people will be to this latest legal development in South Korea?
Well, when I go to Japan, I do read in the press and watch, see on television the reporting on this issue, and I know that there is considerable concern in Japan. And I think the point that many Japanese make is that these rumors were already in the Korean press, South Korean press, and so this Sankei reporter was merely quoting what he saw in the South Korean press, and to be prosecuted for that seemed unreasonable. So I think that given those sets of facts, it probably doesn't look very good for the freedom of press in South Korea.
You think that would affect the improvement, prospect of bilateral improvement between Tokyo and Seoul?
Well, I think this development and also the recent developments about textbooks have been reported widely, South Korean textbooks has been reported widely in Japan. And so as I said in my presentation, you know, I don't believe that the majority of Japanese have become that negative about South Korea. I do think that, and that's why I think the leadership is so important. I think that some individuals, including some political leaders, have taken a view of history which is not consistent with the view that most people in Japan have, or that others in Asia or the United States have. But so I think that, you know, this incident of the Sankei Shimbun reporter will certainly not help the situation. But I think, you know, if, as I argue in my presentation, if the leadership, if the President Park and Prime Minister Abe and their supporters, political supporters, you know, take the decision that it's important to resolve this issue and to move forward, I think it is certainly possible. And I think that, you know, the fact that President Park and Prime Minister Abe each have baggage, historical baggage, in the case of President Park, her father, in the case of Prime Minister Abe, his grandfather, that this makes things more difficult for them. And that's why I propose that, given the fact that 3 years have already passed since the Abe government has come into power, almost 3 years, that there has not yet been a bilateral meeting, that the United States play a more active role in trying to encourage such a improvement in this relationship.
Peter, do you have comments?
The Palestinian textbooks that they use in the West Bank, I got a copy when I went to Israel a number of years ago, and in it, it refers to Jews as monkeys and pigs. I happen to be partially Jewish. My grandfather was born a Jew in Berlin, in Germany, and fled Nazi Germany in 1933. You cannot refer to people as pigs and monkeys and expect them to make peace with you. Similarly, once you say to the Korean women, "I'm sorry," you have said to the Korean women that they are human and on the same plane as you are, and then you can become friends, but only once you say that. And I say that with a deep love and respect for the Japanese people and country, with whom I work a lot on missile defense issues, where they have been extraordinary. But I really think until those words come from the mouth of the Japanese Prime Minister, you can't get over that. And once that is done, Korea and Japan can become real friends, which they are in part today. But that extra step has to be made. Similarly, you now see in the West Bank and in Jerusalem, you see what happens when people still hold others in contempt. They go and murder them, as you're seeing with the Palestinians with knives and guns and so forth. And that isn't going to happen, hopefully, between Japan and Korea. But that step has to be taken, I think. And that's an analogy I think holds, in that you have to speak of others that make them human for you both to become friends.
Thank you, Peter. Dave?
I would say I strongly agree with two key points. Leadership is key, and I think that the Korean-Japanese relationship, a positive one, is key to U.S. interests. So but I'd ask the same question in kind of two ways. What concrete actions could the United States take to try to improve the relationship, if we think we should, or if we should just remain, you know, trying to be neutral and calling it Lean Court Rocks instead of Takto or Takashima? Or the other way to ask that, what would the Japanese or what would the Koreans like the U.S. to do to help resolve the tensions between the two countries?
Well, my proposal is not so much generally on trying to resolve the tensions between South Korea and Japan, because there are so many issues that could be covered. But my focus in my presentation is specifically on this issue of comfort women, because it does appear to be the single issue that has been repeatedly cited as the impediment to having a bilateral summit meeting between the President and the Prime Minister, which I think is quite extraordinary, given the fact that the Prime Minister has been in office for 3 years now, since December of 2012, and there has not been a bilateral two-person summit meeting between the President and the Prime Minister. So to the extent that the President of Korea has repeated, and others have repeated, that it is the comfort women issue that is impeding that meeting, and also largely, more large, in a broader way, the other issues of potential areas of cooperation between the two countries. It's really specifically the comfort women. The issues of territorial disputes and others, I think we should put to the side for the time being. Now, with regard to the comfort women issue in particular, you know, there's actually been, over the last 20 years, considerable discussion and attempts by Japan, certainly Prime Minister Murayama, Mr. Kono, then Mr. Prime Minister Koizumi, to express apology, an attempt through this Asian Women's Fund, which has not been accepted by all, to try to resolve this issue. So I think it's not accurate to say that there hasn't been some real serious efforts on the part of Japan to try to resolve the issue. But, and there have been several times, and in particular, I think, at the time of the Prime Minister, when Prime Minister Noda was in office, 2012-13, when they were very close to reaching a settlement, the two governments, on this issue. And so I think what is needed is a final push to get an agreement on this issue. There's been lots of discussions, lots of attempts, and several times when an agreement was almost reached, and for a variety of reasons, it was never consummated. But I personally believe that the United States should appoint perhaps one person, maybe a couple of people, who are trusted by both South Korea and by Japan. I can think off the top of my head a couple of people who might qualify, one who lives in Cambridge, Massachusetts, one who lives in the Washington, D.C. area, who have been involved with Japan and with Korea for, you know, 40 years or more. They're both highly respected and trusted in both countries, and I think one or both of these individuals should be tasked with the notion of helping to try to get the help in the process, facilitating the process of the Japanese and South Korean officials to try to reach an agreement, reach a resolution of this issue. And I don't know all the details, but it is really a tragedy that on several occasions a settlement was almost reached, but was not able to get there. And I think that, as I say, given the baggage, the historical baggage of the current leaders of South Korea and Japan, it makes it even more difficult. But I think the U.S. really ought to, in its own self-interest as well as in the interest of South Korea and Japan, undertake a more direct effort to help the two countries reach a resolution.
Thank you. Anyone from the floor? Ambassador? Okay, into the microphone, please.
Thank you very much. Is it on? Hello? Is it on?
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Because Mr. Fukushima was not here when I was talking, I'm South Korean ambassador to the United Nations. I spoke a little earlier. When it comes to, I'm no expert on the relationship between Japan and South Korea. I don't deal with it as part of my duty, but because I have been South Korean diplomat for over 30 years. I think you need to look at all these issues in perspective, you know. All these issues between Korea and Japan, including the comfort women issue, Dr. Takeshima issue, textbook issue, all of them have been there at least for the last 25 years. The most recent issue is actually the comfort women issue, because the first victim, the first former comfort woman who came out was in 1991. It took her 46 years to come out. Why? Because for any Asian woman, it's too much of stigma, you know. So they, out of 200,000 comfort women, those who came back to Korea was, we don't have the exact statistics, but not too many. A lot of others stayed where they were, either in China, Southeast Asia, and never came back, or they died on the field. So only those who came back And the first one who came out was 46 years after their experience. So that just tells what kind of experience they had. And so these issues have been there. Even the most recent issue, comfort women, have been there for 25, 24 years. And but all the problems we have, all the strained relation between Japan and South Korea have happened, in my opinion, only during the last 3 years. I have been Korean diplomat for over 30 years. Wherever I am posted, I always have had good ties with Japanese counterparts. Usually they are our best friends, in especially when it comes to UN issues. I think probably we have common position on 99% of all UN issues. There are only difference for 1% of UN issues. So we haven't had any problem. But we now seem to have a little problem, even though they are still my friends, for the last 3 years. Why do you think that happened for the last 3 years? You know, for example, Kono's statement 20 years ago clearly said that there was an involvement of the Japanese military, and there was a certain degree of coercion, and Kono apologized for that. So even though some might have felt that this is not enough, but still there was apology, there was admission of coercion, there was admission of involvement of the Japanese military. So I think that more or less almost settled the issue. But why do we come back to this issue now? Because even though someone is saying that Kono's statement is still respected, they don't act like that. They don't sound like that. So I stop here.
Well, I think, I mean, I don't think you asked a question, but I think I would comment that many people would agree with you. And that's why, I go to Japan about 8 times a year. And I spent a lot of time there. I used to live there for 22 years, and I don't believe that the majority of Japanese people have changed their views as much as has been reported by some of the press. And I think that, as I mentioned in my presentation, the expectation of the Japanese people, the Japanese leadership, is to revive the economy, deal with the demographic problems, and to have Japan play a constructive role in international society. I frankly don't know of too many people, other than some vocal revisionists, who would like to retract what has been said in the past by Prime Minister Maruyama or Mr. Kono. The point is that, as you say, it's the last 3 years that these issues have become such a major problem, and I think that it's leadership. Leadership is essential. If the leadership were to take a different direction on this, I think that the issue, at least in particular this issue of comfort women, is solvable, I believe. And that's why I believe that if the leadership of South Korea and Japan commit to resolving the issue, and if they need, and I believe they probably need some assistance from the outside. I don't, you know, I may be sounding presumptuous here, but I do think that it would be helpful for the United States to take a more active role in trying to help resolve the issue. But I'd be kind of curious to ask you, do you think that the United States could play a role in this, or do you think that the United States should not be playing a role? Because if you assume that the United States would not play a role, I'm frankly not so optimistic that a resolution of this issue can be expected in a short period of time.
Well, I want to say just one comment regarding this discussion, that is United States' role in improving bilateral relations between Seoul and Tokyo is limited. And in fact, the Tony Blinken, Undersecretary of State, Deputy Secretary for that matter, not long ago said United States is not in not mediating the relations between the two countries, but encouraging improved relations as part of a trilateral security relationship, which will serve part of the strategy for U.S. rebalancing to Asia. But speaking of a trilateral security relationship, Korea and Japan had really no problem with each other until former President Lee Myung-bak, it was the same day he was about to sign an agreement with Japan to share defense information, but he went to Tokyo Island. After that, that ended. Any dialogue or any talk, and that was the end of any chance for improving relations. But we all recognize that Japan is taking up more security roles, especially under Abe leadership. And Abe, no doubt, is a very strong leader. And Washington welcomes his strong leadership in bolstering the bilateral alliance between Japan and Korea, and his increased the collective security role as well. But having said all that, why is it you said it's going to be leadership of the two countries that will have to resolve this issue? But I think what is the simplest solution would be if Abe says, well, he says he regards all the statements made by the previous Japanese administrations or prime ministers and so forth. Instead of saying that, why can he reiterate some of the key phrases? For example, that was stated in Kono statement, okay? Ambassador O referred to. And they will solve the issue. Why is it so difficult for Abe, strong leader, to say that?
Well, I don't presume to get into the mind of the prime minister, but I think he has certain views of history that are not necessarily orthodox views of post-war Japan.
That's not because of his grandfather on mother's side, is it?
Well, I think he has some influence from his grandfather, but I think also that
his grandfather has not been, by the way, tried as a war criminal, but he was waiting for trial, but he was released before the tribunal took up the case. Thank you, Joe.
But let me just add one other point, which is that let's see. I lost my train of thought. It was to say that, Prime Minister Abe obviously is a politician, and so I think one of the issues that I think everyone recognizes is that during the time that he stepped down as Prime Minister in 2007 and the time he regained the Prime Ministership in 2012, during those 5 years or so, he was out in the wilderness. And he had some people who were very much supportive of him in trying to make the comeback. And I think many of these people are people that he feels he needs to consider their views. And many of these people are people who, I think, go to Yasukuni Shrine and have a view of history that is not consistent necessarily with the statements made by Prime Minister Murayama and Koizumi. So I think there's both an issue of Abe's views of history, whatever influence that may come from, as well as the political support that he believes he needs. And so I think we should keep both of those in mind. And that's precisely why I think it would be helpful to have the United States involved in trying to have the two countries reach a resolution.
Thank you. Jill?
In answer to the ambassador's question, why has it been stirred up in the past 3 years? I have a hypothesis. Which country has benefited from this split,
China,
the erosion of the U.S., Korea, Japanese triumvirate relationship? China. Is it possible that China has played a hand in stirring these historical grievances up?
Regions of influence. Yes.
Very interesting. Talk about the one in Cambridge. I was trying to get Ezra Vogel here.
Ah, I see. Yeah.
someone else?
Well, I was thinking Joe Nye would be another person.
Joe Nye, okay. No. He has a full question.
Well, maybe we have three people then.
Okay, now. Peter, would you bring the microphone to Peter Kang, yes? Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Peter Kang, Korea Freedom Alliance. This freedom stands for, we work for Free United Korea, and in case you don't know, our adversary is North Korean regime, also leftists in the United States and in South Korea. My very quick 10-second question or comment is about Japan issue. A couple of people said that Abe should say certain things. In my opinion, U.S. leadership, for example, President Obama suggests that to Japanese Prime Minister, why don't you say so? Then I think the problem will be solved. That's my simplistic view. Instead of you try to figure out yourself, so that will perpetuate the quarrel between the two countries. What I'm raising now is the issue of China and Park Geun-hye's visit last week. You talked several times this afternoon about Park Geun-hye's approaching too closely to possibly the opinion of approaching closely to China, and the U.S. complaining why South Korea is not making any comment about South China Sea issue. To start with, I would like to say that China is a critical factor, not ultimate factor, but critical factor to solving North Korean problem, unification problem. So China has a key to that. Now, China, we don't know what China is thinking. I asked many times, I heard many people, they don't know. Some people say that China is vacillating. Some people say China has different opinions among different leaders. Okay, in the worst case, China may not want unification. So in other words, China may be cheating Park Geun-hye to come out and help opposing United States. But I don't think that is the case. I think, my opinion is China is probably, we don't know exactly, but we can influence China. I think in that sense, Park Geun-hye did a good job attending Beijing parade, showing that, okay, we are with you. You can help us to solve nuclear problem and unification. China may be vacillating, but if we keep influencing, China may come toward to help us more. So I think President Park did a pretty good job attending that. And I think we should keep working, trying to persuade China toward solving North Korean problem. That's my quick thinking about China. And
all right, thank you, Peter. Thank you, Peter. Any? Okay, Seiji? Kenji?
Yeah. Look. My question, recently President Park visited here and promoting unification bonanza. Then Japan, Korea, China also economically downsizing. So then how about the Prime Minister Abe November, they promoting bonanza idea. So unification is bonanza means economically bonanza. Maybe I believe that Japan also helping economically bonanza also. Northeast Asia will be peace and prosperity will be confirmed. How do you think the idea of Prime Minister himself promoting unification is bonanza with
I didn't understand your last yeah. Can you repeat your last sentence?
How about Abe himself
yes.
Promote unification, Korea unification is bonanza. It means working together, helping unification, Korean unification to be bonanza and the prosperity of Northeast Asia.
Thank you.
Well, I don't know. I don't know. I actually haven't thought about Mr. Abe or Mr. Obama or anyone encouraging unification. I mean, I suppose it's a matter for the South Koreans and the North Koreans to decide. So I don't know how appropriate it would be for the leader of another country to talk about unification.
Well, I just have to say, though, that in the 2009 Joint Vision Statement, the ROC-U.S. Alliance has said peaceful unification is the desired end state. So I think, you know, we have to keep that in mind. And I your question, I think it would be helpful. I think Japan, you know, to say that, you know, they support unification, I think that would be very, very helpful.
The trouble is they talk about it, but they never do anything.
Is your microphone to this man, please?
Thank you to the panel, Mr. Fukushima. I'd just like to have your comment. It's obviously the threat is North Korea and China. And China knows, and North Korea knows as well. So I would say perhaps if you think if Japan, along with South Korea and other nations in the Asian, would unify themselves, make a coalition, then China and North Korea will start behaving a little bit differently. At the same time, the United States should build better coalition with Russia because Russia has a player in the area. So on the balance of power, if the United States will build more better coalition with Russia, then China and North Korea, you think, will behave differently?
Thank you very much for your comments. No further questions. We hit the right. Okay, there's one gentleman. Please identify yourself.
Thank you very much. My name is Ben Bangura. I'm a Washington-based journalist with very little no knowledge about the issue you're discussing today. My questions may have been answered, but I would like to know what does Japan have in common with South Korea? And what are the dividing issues in today's geopolitics?
Okay, why don't we do this?
It's another conference, I think.
Okay, that's another whole thing now. Our reception will start right now.
Absolutely.
Why don't reception. We have wine and glass, beer, and food? Then let's continue. Okay. Ladies right. and gentlemen, thank you very much.